Hi.
Oh,
Oh,
we're
we're
welcome
back.
back to the Archon Team League. Quip, sit up. You gotta show up.
You've actually been
Oh.
gradually getting lower
Uh-oh.
and lower.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
It's a
Which
curse I
is
passed.
All
right.
hilarious because when we all stand, Crypt towers over us.
Not
It's
true.
literally like the Empire State Center versus like everything
State
else. Or
Center.
Empire.
What am
Oh,
I
God.
then?
Oh, God. All right. No, no, no.
I'm like
It's
a
fine. No,
fly.
don't
Let's
worry
draw
about
the
it. Yeah,
analogy
you're all
for
right.
that.
You're all
Yeah.
right.
What am I thinking of?
All right, Hearthstone. Hearthstone. So how about that? We got Nylan versus Valley Town.
Okay. So
Yep.
like, what?
All right. Well,
Okay.
Crypt made this really awkward. That's something that we're very used to here in
I tried to
Hearthstone.
bury it, and you guys just didn't want to bury it with me.
Yeah.
Well, I mean,
I tried to
you're
bury it
supposed
by
to help
myself, and
support,
it didn't
so.
work, you know?
Yeah.
Well,
It's a tough
as a
job.
co-caster, we're there to help each other instead of, adding on to
Okay.
Yeah.
the
Well, why
failure.
was the GG button that way?
Yeah, it's RGG
Probably
button. That's
double
a good
tap.
reset. Welcome back, everybody, to the Archon Team League Championship, day number one. It's time for Valleytown versus Nilum, and I'm going to try my best to say that. I've been apparently calling it wrong all season. It's not Nihilum. It's Nihilum.
Oh, let me
So
try.
beat it into your tongues.
Nihilum. Okay.
Nihilum.
All right.
Wow.
Well, I think I nailed it, so I'll just keep calling it
You're
that.
pretty good, Crypt. Turns
Yeah.
out you're pretty
Yeah.
good.
Yeah, it's
Yeah.
good. You're good at talking.
Yeah.
We have one more match, and then we have Jeparino, and then we're done for the day. Just like that. But each match, it does feel, a little bit grueling. There's a lot of intensity to it. I was talking to Strifegro, and he was like, "Yeah, I was really nervous." He's like, "I was worried that we were gonna lose momentum, and then get cornered when I got benched." All
Yeah.
these different things.
Yeah.
Well, they were in that bad spot. It's just
Yeah.
Ecop got the right cards, he played it right, and really it was just circumstance. I mean, Gaara had one line of play that he thought was correct. I think you can't really argue that he was wrong objectively,
Yeah.
but it certainly didn't work out for
It
him.
didn't work out, and then there was also other instances, like every game that they were talking to me, where they were like, "Oh, he did." Like, for example, he chose to charge Druid of the Claw to taunt it against Lotheb and the weapon,
Right.
and that also ended up costing the board for doing that. And so there's a lot of like little small subtle things that people can always argue both ways, but we can use hindsight to always be like, "Yeah, of course, in
Yeah,
a perfect
we just know
implementation."
better. We
Yeah.
have the hindsight.
Yeah. I mean, Crypt was runner up at BlizzCon
Yeah.
2014,
I
2013,
was down in the
2014.
dumpster, like
Well,
I
who
was like
cares?
way down.
I have a cup.
Yeah.
That's
Right.
right. Yeah,
Yeah.
man.
Yeah.
We've been having fun here. Hope you guys have too. Make sure to hashtag ATLC. We've been featuring tweets. Make sure you can
Right.
get connect too. And I want to also shout out our, some of our sponsors for making this possible. They've been all throughout the broadcast, but we appreciate you guys been sticking with us. We have one more match, and then we have the Jeparino, and then tomorrow we have three matches as well. We're going to continue the seeding bracket. Don't worry, Templestorm lost, but they still have a chance
Yeah.
to go through. Same thing if they lose tomorrow. If they lose tomorrow, they still can win the whole thing.
Well,
Theoretically, right,
even
yeah.
if you lose like all your games in the group stages,
You
you
can. You
can
have to
can
win
win.
three.
You can
You
win.
have to go
You can win the
three and two.
tournament. Yeah. It's just yeah, it's far less likely. It's if you look at the overall number of wins that you need, if you end up like last, you need more than the other players. Like if your team
Yeah.
wins today, wins again tomorrow,
You
you
need
get
like
that
one more,
2-0,
yeah.
you only need to win one more. So you only need to win a total of three games.
Well, actually, if you go 0-2, you have to only win three games.
Yeah. So I guess
Oh,
like
yeah, that's true.
the worst part
Actually,
is going 1-2, right?
the worst is actually going 2-1 because you have to win three. Actually, 1-2 and 2-1 both have to
1-2,
win four
yeah.
games.
Four
Yeah.
games,
games.
yeah.
So yeah, you want either first or last in the group
So
seeding for a
Templestorm,
minimal amount of wins.
right? So Templestorm's like
Yeah.
best line of play here is to lose tomorrow, just like
It's but there is, I mean,
yeah.
maybe there's actually some strategy that if we actually think about it, like the first time it's going in my head here,
Once you've lost the first one,
because you can go like 0-2, you still only need to win three.
right?
You get to change your decks for the final
Ending,
stage of
yeah,
the tournament.
right.
Maybe
Well,
you just
surprising.
throw your opponent some garbage,
Yeah,
and then on the
sandbag.
last day you come up with like some meta crushing
Maybe that's
bets,
exactly what's happening.
or not.
Yeah, or not.
Yeah.
I mean, here's the reality. If you win two games and advance through group stages in first, second, you get at least guaranteed
Yeah.
$10,000 per player. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
So that's what these guys are playing for. Valleytown, they come in here as a team that's often the fan favorites. They have a lot of like, lovable characters, and then you have Team Nilum, like a very team of dominant players. Like all these guys won their way onto the scene. None of them like had a big stream going into it, and then you saw them like become characters that you wanted to win, and they got that win. Versus Valleytown has that, right?
So
Kibler
you're, what you're
and
saying is like skill
Okay.
versus fame, right?
That's one way we can phrase it. I think it's more about, like, it's a story of the people who... I mean, Dog's not really part of that group,
right?
But people who come from that aspect of
streaming. I'm just being facetious, but yes, definitely.
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's a valid concern in the community. Yeah. They're always like, these guys are popular, but then Trump started winning some stuff. Kibler's now best performing player.
Trump is, like, fifth in the world.
Yeah, he's, like, really good right now, ranking-wise.
Yeah, he's won a lot recently. Yeah. And
so, I mean, he's certainly earned his way at the very least recently. I mean, he's gone... I think Trump was kind of struggling maybe in the first like year. Hearthstone really proved himself. He was doing fine, like the 50% win rate area in most tournaments, but because he was an invited player, that's still pretty good. But recently, he's stepped up. I think his overall win rate from 50 to 60. And it's not like that you just won a few more games.
Yeah.
That's like you won a lot of games to change that ratio.
With that many tournaments that you played.
So Trump's been killing it recently.
After GVG, I think like he really picked up the game. Anyway.
So it's going to be that, Nylum versus Team Value Town. Mm-hmm. And coming up, we have a video to show you guys before we get ready for our second match. Coming up now.
Any moment.
Or now.
Previously, on the Archon Team League Championship, Tempo Storm gets a little bit lucky against Nylum.
Well, seems like that's the play.
I can't see anything else. I mean, Varian Wrynn, what is it weak to? Like, you know it's weak to Light Bomb, of course. Like, that's pretty much a given.
Yeah, at this point. Ooh!
Alright, Life Coach decides this Ysera is too valuable for my opponent. I can't let it sit there. If it wins the ball! Oh my god.
Wow!
Down goes Vanruki.
Oh, that just lost the game.
Yeah, that's really painful. This is what we call getting annihilated.
Well, I mean, even though the dude here is very important not to play a hero power. And oh! Oh, that is
Dice is bricking on every street, but he's guaranteed lethal for the next turn if he can just not give Eloise any health.
No health.
No health. And you know what's funny?
Dodge the Huskar Jouster, dodge the antique heal bot.
Dodge everything.
Alright, what's this gonna be?
Oh my god!
Oh baby, it's triple!
Breathing a sigh of relief. Okay. Oh, she's like, I can't believe I got this. But Thais is gonna top deck, right? It's just gonna be a counter top deck.
No, it might be just a. What could it be? It could be Ice Barrier.
It could be Ice Barrier. It could be Ice Barrier.
And it would be like just terrible.
No, don't say that, Amaz. Don't say that. Don't say that.
And oh my! Oh, brutal.
All right. Well,
so got lucky twice.
I thought there had to be like more lucky and unlucky moments in the tournament so far.
I was like, oh yeah, I thought it was gonna be like a montage of like crazy brawl shredders and like. A bunch of like unstable portal stuff, but I guess
it's like two clips. I guess that qualifies like a lot of luck.
Yeah, I guess he literally meant a little lucky because that's what it was.
Yeah, just a little lucky. One out of four.
Yeah. So those are some highlights. You guys can always check out the VODs as well.
Absolutely.
A lot of good times to be shared. But classes are up.
Yeah, classes are up indeed. There's warlocks. Oh yeah.
Interesting. There's a shaman. Oh, I was really hoping he'd start shaman too.
Yeah.
Because I think one of these surprise classes are always best to just throw it out immediately and just win.
Mm-hmm.
Just like stun everybody with the shaman.
Yeah, it's happened before. The thing is, shaman right now, there's a weird, there's a few archetypes. There's the control shaman that a lot of people play with dragons. I don't know if you've played it. Actually, yeah, it's getting pretty popular now.
It's definitely strong, but it's not popular.
I think it's strong but not popular. Sure,
yeah, the word is like it's viable. Yeah.
Right, viable. Deck.
Never seen the deck.
Elemental Destruction is all I have to say. Though.
Yeah, Elemental Destruction, good card. I'm playing Malygos Shaman a little bit.
Oh,
it's not too bad.
Yeah,
I feel like it's a type of deck where if it's just good enough, it's like totally crazy.
Yeah,
and I feel like it's almost good enough the way I played it.
It's missing one or two things to like just. Blast.
You're like always one turn away from just completely owning your opponent.
Yeah.
So I think with some tweaks and some practice, I don't know if we're really going to see anything like that in this tournament because I think those type of details take a long time to edge out.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. But maybe in the future.
All right. So we have Kibler on Hunter, which I assume is mid range just based on the Houndmaster. And
It's a safe assumption for sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think mid-range Hunter still has a lot of dominance over the Druid, just because it's difficult for Druid to climb over the early game curve of Hunter, especially with a coin 2-2-3-4 play that lands a Houndmaster to finish it off. Druids need to find early game, like Wildgrove sometimes isn't even enough. You need like Innervate into like a dominant board position with Shredders into Druid the Claws.
It's also important to note that the Innervate plays often don't even work because Freeze Trap just counters it so hard.
Yeah. Right.
Like we saw Freeze Trap counter Paladin earlier, right?
Right.
And, and Drew's on another level of getting countered against Freeze Trap.
It's like you innervate it for two cheaper and you get it for two more expensive
later on.
So Magic Leader, here's a good thing is that it forces your opponent not to play Wild Growth if they have a removal piece, right? They might decide to skip over it, then you might get the juggler to swing at least once.
Okay, that's interesting. I think most players actually play the Creeper first, though.
Yeah, they usually do.
Trying to get the
for safety.
Yeah, the safety.
But this is for damage because he has a very good curve, and if he doesn't if he chooses to wrath this over, or doesn't choose to wrath over Wild Growth, it's a lot of damage.
Yeah,
I just think if you want to make a coin play and you look at the hand you want to make a coin play, it's a 1-2-3-4-5 actually. Well, that's
yeah,
a 1-2-3-4-5,
it's actually
right?
insane.
So you're coining, right? But I think the idea is that if you play the Creeper and you want to follow up with the Juggler to get better trades, it's not going to happen against the Druid because there's like no Druid two drops except the Darnassus, which. I mean, you can't really say for sure as in decks. We've seen some Druid decks just skip the card now.
Yeah. And the thing is, the Creeper might not kill it with a Juggler, so you want to make sure you can kill it with your own. That's a pretty okay draw for Thais.
Yeah, I'm still scared about everything Hunter can do on 3. This is a very big deal because that Knife Juggler will now get another hit, maybe even 2 if it's protected well behind whatever animal companion comes out.
Yeah.
And not to mention Eaglehorn Bow can also threaten the Shredder.
Right.
So it's just like this problem of too much damage being taken and then you're in trouble.
Yeah, but Thais is an excellent Druid player. I mean, he knows the matchup inside and out. Like, I think he's the only player in ATLC which through the days pre-TGT had a good win rate.
No,
positive
win rate. Everyone else had a negative win rate with Druid.
Yeah, so Thais knows how to play the class. It's actually what made him popular back in the King of the Hill days.
He's a
double
rat. I mean, back in the day, Thais was one of those guys who won 5 Zotac Cups in a month. And there's only 4 weeks in a month. Normally. He actually won an EU and an NA
and
the
NA
same
at the
day.
Same time. Yeah.
Well, I didn't know that.
And that was like, and then he won 10 King of the Hill show matches against like Strifecrow and like all these other really dominant players. So and of course, RDU did the same thing like. In terms of earning his name in Life Coach, this year has been one of the players to look out for.
Ooh, what about here? Houndmaster on the creature with taunt.
And just do you go? The problem is the Drake being up.
Yeah, the spell damage is so threatening.
Yeah, but you've seen 2 wraths, so there's a swipe left, and that's about it. Maybe Living Root. So maybe you wouldn't care about the swipe if you play Houndmaster because you put. Then again, you would pop the creeper. Yeah, you have to kill the Drake, unfortunately.
What if you just kill Command? You're Lothar being next turn, probably.
That's a great point. You could kill Command. If you buff the Misha, well, then Swipe's not as big an issue.
Yeah, so Swipe's still not really an issue if you kill the Drake here.
Yeah.
Swipe's still an issue. Like, you just swipe the Houndmaster and then take 6.
I think you're okay with that thing, because you follow with Lotheb, and then you have more damage from the hand.
Well, that's a lot of damage.
Lotheb's
going to
run into the Ancient of War, though. I think Thais can stabilize this game. He's got the heal as well, so he doesn't get attrition.
Yeah. I think, the double Wrath... I don't know if that's a play that a lot of people would have made. I know myself, I might have just wrathed for 3. The double wrath is what allows him to actually keep up, because drawing cards with this wrath is basically guaranteeing that you can stay in the game for the long term, as opposed to just getting punished right away. Wow.
Thorsen opens up...
Kill Command, kills
it. What does it open up for the next following turn?
Shredder, Swipe, Darnassus.
Yeah.
That's a play. Oof. Do you just ignore it and just push face?
I think you Lotheb.
That's so much damage.
It, yeah. If you Lotheb, it effectively negates whatever
what
you just reduced spell-wise.
Bow Freeze Trap and just face.
I like that.
That's
like
the most
face.
Damage. That is the most
damage. That is the most damage. Because you get 2 weapon hits over 2 turns.
Right.
And Druids aren't known for their ability to heal up a lot. I mean, Ancient of Lore might come in as a clutch heal, but they don't run heal bots unless they play like a really slow type of deck.
Which... Mind I remind you of Tree of Life?
Please do not.
Druids are known to heal a lot.
Okay, yeah, sure.
it's the best one
actually,
happens in life.
The most.
The most, yeah, in the entire game.
I feel like I feel like Tree of Life doesn't actually win that many games against Hunter, especially if they're mid-range. But on ladder, when you play it, Hunters are like, yeah, I'm just not going to waste my
time. I'm going to fix that statement for you. Tree of Life doesn't win many games. Period.
Period. Yeah.
Exclamation point.
All right, so the Emperor's basically done nothing. Like, you got Ancient of War here. Like, what does it really stop? Nothing from Thais.
It stops 10 damage, hypothetically, but...
Yeah, I think that's the play. I think Ancient of War Darnassus is the only play you can try to stabilize it.
I think what's cool is that he's...
Still alive?
Well, is that he's not dead, and there are ways for him to turn it around. But he's gonna definitely need to get a little bit fortunate.
Whoa, Kibler with the tracking. I'm
what if
liking
it
this.
Gets that owl for the lethal.
Yeah. That might be a good consideration. I mean, like, your curve would probably either way consist of a kill command being sprinkled in with either trap or hero power.
If you tracking,
unless you
want to
play
though,
the bow.
If you're tracking, though, you can't use the bow.
Yeah, that's the issue.
But if you're tracking the owl, you just win. So I think there's a pretty easy choice. If he has an owl in the deck.
Yeah, that's also a possibility. He probably might not have an owl.
Yeah. Oh, there he goes.
Hunter's Mark.
Almost.
Go. Hunter's Mark. Let's do this.
Oh, Instacart? It just automatically weaved.
He didn't even
tracking
ask.
Said, draw your next Iron Beak Owl.
Wow, that was ridiculous. Thank you, Spectator Mode, for this golden moment. This was
How did
this
he
was
even
great.
Click that so quickly?
Maybe he has three
All
owls.
All those years of MTGO, man.
Oh god, yeah, skip.
Jeez.
F6.
Yeah, F6.
Maybe it's just new Blizzard AI.
Oh goodness.
If you have lethal, automatically picks that.
Actually, what happened was, this is a new feature. Whenever you play tracking, and there's an owl for lethal, it actually highlights an orange.
Well, okay.
Well, I like that because
just
it's more friendly
red,
for newer players. Like, a lot
red is bad. So,
oh, is
it?
When
actually,
when do you get red?
Not only does it make an orange border around the owl, but it X's the other two cards for
you. And then you draw immediately, and you're
try
like,
to
what's
on the card?
Deck?
I must not pick that.
It just keeps getting error message.
Yeah,
shuts down hard, so you have to reconnect to the client.
Yes, I think so. All right. There's Trump. There's Dog.
All right, the tier crafting.
In case you forget which one Trump is, he's wearing his own face.
Yeah.
Is that a pencil? Oh, God.
No, it's a pencil.
Trump is very old-fashioned.
He's literally trying to be that guy from Baby Steps.
That shirt is literally going to give me nightmares.
Yeah, I don't know why. That it's like...
You set yourself way too easily to be trolled from that one, Krim. Declaring that to the world. Well, they're off to a good start, and I think this is a simple decision tree of like what classes are available. We know that, for example, Nilum has Shaman still.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of these weird like curveballs. Like, how do you account for it? Is it going to be like Mech Shaman? Because we know that was established early in the season. But TGT came out, and some people are saying mid-range Shaman isn't so bad. A few people have innovated it. Fake has been playing a lot of mid-range Shaman. Loyan's been playing a lot of mid-range Shaman. And they're hitting like reasonable Legend ranks with it.
Thais can't be the Druid player, by the way. That makes no sense, right? There's got to be a swap somewhere.
Yeah.
RDU is more the Shaman player of Nihil.
I think RDU is more of the Paladin player, if anything.
Okay,
so
that
would
go
Shaman,
and Shaman and
right,
Paladin might
right.
be RDU.
Okay.
You're right. The other thing that I'm kind of noticing is, you know, often just post expansions, people often get rewarded for playing just really wild decks. But in this format, I mean, you only take one game out of six with a wild deck. So it seems like the risk might just not be worth it at all.
In the sense that it can get punished a lot easily, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if it's RDU playing that Shaman, I know RDU has really loved Mech Shaman.
Yeah.
And maybe he's found more inspiration through some of those... like, what TGT cards would even help Mech Shaman? Mech Knight.
Ancestral Knowledge for top decks.
Actually, Ancestral Knowledge. Right.
Clockwork Knight.
Clockwork Knight, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
You'll get wrecked in
Jeopardy. I'm going to get this
shit. Not by me, though.
By Noxus.
So what are you going to do with your $5,000?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't even know if
buy,
I can
buy,
I haven't
buy
played,
a razor.
I haven't played the cards. Oh, damn. Shots fired. No, I haven't really, like, I haven't practiced enough like this time around. I think Crib might take it, to be honest.
I don't know.
All right.
I don't think so. I actually practiced.
Clockwork Knight. I don't even.
Okay.
There it is. So, already 100 points for Noxious. We'll start off there.
What? I got that one right.
And Crib. Actually, let's just make it even. Negative 100 for Broden.
We should just tag team versus him, you know?
Actually, yeah. Let's combine our points and split the prize money.
Yeah.
That sounds fair.
Yeah, it does. All right, speaking of fair, we have Life Coach playing probably Patron Warrior and Dog on Druid.
Yeah.
Have we seen Druid from Dog recently?
Well, he was known as a Ramp Druid player back in the day,
yeah.
But I don't feel like I've seen a modern Druid from Dog. He's played like Rogue and he's played Mage a lot.
Yep. Yeah.
I spoke to Dog about Druid, and he said, I hate the class, I'm tired of it, I've played too much when I first started playing. So maybe TGT revived it in some form or another for him. But he didn't seem like he wanted to go away from Rogue and Mage. Like, you know, those two have been his core classes for a while now.
Yeah, the problem with Rogue is that it's become even more volatile because a lot of decks have shored up even more of their early game, and that's where Rogue struggles the most because they're stuck hero powering. So it feels like Rogue's not in a very good position. It's almost certainly the bottom deck right now in terms of team conquest, I think. But I don't know, maybe we see one Rogue.
I don't know.
Oh, no, we've seen...
I told you earlier, I've literally not played against the Rogue
at all
since TGT. Yeah.
Like in Arena or in...
Oh, in Arena, I play against a lot.
Yeah, every time. Because
it feels like it's actually the other way around. Like, Rogue might be pretty good in Arena.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, maybe one of the best classes.
It is one of the best classes because it counters Paladin so hard and that's gone up. But anyway, we're talking about Constructed. Rogue, yeah, never played against it since TGT and Constructed.
I'd be kind of sad if it didn't make an appearance at all in the finals. But, I mean, we've seen the four teams, and even though we know the deck lists, there is a possibility for them to submit Rogue for day number three. Assuming someone between now and the next 48 hours, they can find the optimal Rogue list that can completely destroy the
field. Yeah, a lot of people seem to think it would be like a modification on Oil, where you just take the Oil deck and modify it a little bit.
That's kind of been the case, how it's survived since GVG.
Pretty much, yeah. It hasn't really
changed. Thrived. It's not really survived. Yeah. Rogue's just been fairly good since GVG's introduction of Oil. Yeah, it hasn't. I mean, Rogues did get a weapon on TGT.
Yeah.
It's just not one you want to Blade Flurry most of the time.
Yeah, it's so
they
awkward.
They actually got two. They got Poison Blade, the Justicar True Heart buff.
Oh my god.
Off the hero power.
Oh, yes.
You're right.
The Justicar.
The crazy weapon. In the 2-2 Rogue. Weapon. Like the Buccaneer for 6
wow.
mana. Yeah.
And, right. And you think you'll lose at Jeopardy?
Yeah, you know that more than I didn't even think of that.
Like, you surprised like every person watching right now.
It's like we're setting up the player PC right now, just making sure we can set up. I heard some of the players were saying that there was maybe like a mouse problem or whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
At least that was the excuse Hype was using. It's like, yeah, man. You know, the mouse wasn't working, so I clicked on the execute over there.
I've heard of Reyna use that one before.
Yeah.
Maybe it lives through the team, you know?
It is. We actually do that in our morning pledges. We don't pledge allegiance to the flag. We pledge allegiance to our excuses.
Oh, wow.
You know, that's a good way to... You can never quite lose that way.
But he was right, actually. I think it was one of the tournaments last year. He tried to, like, kill command something, but his mouse
right,
died.
Yeah.
So it just hit, like, a random creature on the board.
Mm-hmm. Like that one.
Whether or not it's true, it's just, like, either the most amazing situation or the most hilarious excuse. Like, either way, it's hilarious.
Yeah.
It's a win-win.
I think so.
Yeah.
All right. If not, we should give him an Oscar for acting.
All right. Well, no doubt, patron from Life Coach. I think I have not... Like, I tend to see what other people are doing. Every time I've seen Life Coach playing the game, I've seen him play Patron Warrior.
These days, yeah.
Yeah. It feels like it's right up Life Coach's alley with a lot of counting and whatnot. Dog, in the meantime, pretty reasonable hand. He's got some early ramp. Not as guaranteed with the Aspirant versus the Fiery War Axe, but he still has the Innervate, so that allows him to grab early tempo.
Yeah, he's not a big fan of the double Aspirant list, as far as I know. Double War Axe in Life Coach's hand, that's a bit clunky, isn't it?
I think like we saw patrons cut back on the one War Axe, but I think that was largely because they were just facing other patrons and just a lot
so
of other
put Harrison instead.
Yeah.
Yeah, makes sense.
But these days you just face off against very, very aggressive decks, and I think the Fire War Axe is very important to staying alive in the mid and late game.
Yeah. It's weird though, because War Axe still has some interesting interactions with fast decks, like especially decks like Paladin that has Shield and Minibot, and how do you use Fiery War Axe to get efficiency off that? Not to mention they still have Noble Sacrifice with Avenge.
You still have to get through that, though.
Exactly. So Fiery War Axe does still effectively hit the aggro stuff, but sometimes it doesn't even work.
Deal with it, yeah. I mean, in this case, it's probably the best.
Life Coach looks really stressed right now.
It was a breakfast. It was really good.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, it wasn't good
at
all.
Is he thinking about his breakfast?
Yeah.
Because I am.
I don't think he's thinking about breakfast right now. I have a feeling he's actually thinking about the Hearthstone.
He looks livid. And
probably. Yeah. Okay, so it's very clear that he's going to Fiery War Axe this thing down, right?
No, he might just go like...
No, he will kill this. It's about his follow-up plays. What Left Coach always tells is that he borrows time from the previous turn to think for the next turn.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
And then redo it all over again
Yes.
on the following turn. Wow, Dog's Hand is probably the worst I've ever seen in a long time for a Druid player.
Well, he can't innervate swipe to push his lead further.
That's it. But I think hero powering is probably pushing his lead just as far.
Okay.
I like Savage Roar here. I don't know about you, but I thought Savage Roar was perfectly fine.
On curve.
Yeah, on curve.
That's, you were talking about it, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes it's better to follow curve. I think I remember one time. I think it may have happened on your stream where some druid innervates Savage Roar against you, or something like that. Like turn one. This was like when Hearthstone was pretty new. I think I remember like. Because it was like one of those things, or maybe it was one of your.
I've been innervate hero powered by a druid when he went first.
But innervate Savage Roar turn one.
I don't remember that. It may have happened. Yeah, you never know. I mean, it looks
there's
like a good play.
Some bold people.
Yeah, it's like I could do 2 damage later, or possibly do some more. But I could do 2 damage right now.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Life Coach is obviously just thinking about future options still.
Yeah.
Dog is probably like, are you kidding me, man? Like what is gonna happen? Like, Zombie Chow in a rage? Like, is this what's going on right now?
There's no way for zero, like, one mana, effectively.
Yeah, there's no way to play anything relevant on one mana with the Patron Warrior. There's no way.
Yeah. Speaking of, nothing else to do.
Wow, that is a draw.
Yeah, I mean, I guess
that helps. That is a card. As I heard its term.
Well, those were 2 cards, actually.
Yeah, okay. That's how you innervated the Emperor.
Well, the Emperor was the main relevant one.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, that was the A card.
There were 2 cards in that exchange.
All right.
How good is Shield Slam? I mean, do you
You're
just
gonna
slam
meme do it right?
How good is Shield Slam?
Yeah. Tell me.
Turns out it's pretty good.
Sweet. would he slam and trade with the Axe here, or actually waste, quote-unquote, the Shield Slam? Since he's got a Shield Block on the back, right? You could just hold on to it.
I kind of like the slam, plus you get efficiency just from the armor up.
Right.
Cycling is really powerful.
Yeah, I like the slam a lot.
The alternative is to shield block now, because it's more expensive, and you might get still some value off of other stuff. And you get to keep your Fiery War Axe, so you can develop Thorsen later.
Of your own, yeah.
And you still keep the weapon for threat. So that is a valuable option as well. In fact, the more I think about it, the more I kind of like Shield Block now, because you already got the damage in anyways, so that Battle Rage is live.
And the more I like it, I like Slam now. Yep. Oh, Life Coach knows. Oh, what happened? Oh, man.
The mouse glitch.
Is it a mouse glitch?
I don't know. No, it looked like one.
He's fine.
Okay. Was he considering?
He doesn't look fine. There's something horribly wrong going on right now.
Yeah, you can keep the Shield Slam as well for flexibility in following turns.
I'd say, like, watching Life Coach, not the actual game, is, like, the most entertaining part right now.
Yeah. This is... Like, if you'd kept the innervate, he would actually be able to play Dr. Boom right now?
Yeah, I guess so.
But why would you ever
keep
the
innervate? Then he'd do nothing the previous turn.
Yeah.
Wow, pass on turn 5. He's also going to pass on turn 6, by the way.
Yeah, it's looking like
Well, I think Life Coach will end up playing some...
Patron Innervate Coin Whirlwind, that's pretty sweet.
No, he won't.
No,
he can play Shield Block here.
Yeah,
I guess
I think you can just Shield Block.
The problem with the Whirlwind Inner Rage thing is that you invest a lot into the board,
and it's just a risk.
It's a risk that you don't necessarily need to do.
Is it a risk against Druid? What are they gonna do? Like Starfall with Bloodmage Thalnos and some random variant of Dog's Druid?
Well, it actually, I think coincidentally plays into exactly Dog's hand, doesn't it? Because he has Wrath, Savage Roar, and Slayer.
He's gonna have to use all those cards to deal with that one patron. And
I'm not sure
and
that's enough.
I mean, maybe he's able to.
Yeah,
you're right.
Like, you Wrath one, Savage Roar the other.
Oh yeah, you're right. You're right.
So it's
right.
Actually, he just dumped 3.5 cards, and I dealt with this.
With 3.
Yeah, with 3. So in a very odd way, Dog has perfectly countered this. And the thing is. It's really hard to account for it too because you know Thorsten.
You can't, you can't. Like, I think there's a point where you can't account for all the combinatorics of like Thorsten plays.
Yeah,
and this is not a hand you'd expect the Druid to end up with, really. Like, because all those cards you don't expect to be kept in the board.
Yes and no. He did pass
right
on turn 5 after Thorsten. It's like basically
there had to be at least 2 of those.
It's either spells or all 7 drops.
Yeah, or maybe double combo or some kind of ridiculous combination.
No, even if 7 drops, you could play because of Thor's. It's like, he actually... Yeah.
It was nothing.
I feel like Life Coach is just talking to someone right now. Oh, yeah. Oh.
In German or English?
I don't know. It's just awesome.
It looks like German, but I don't know what it sounds like.
Yeah, maybe he's counting how much money he's going to make this weekend on his hand.
Akali's kind of cool.
Yeah, I mean, you've seen a Wrath. Give it a shot. You haven't seen Keeper, though, so maybe you're a little worried.
Yeah, you want to get at least one draw.
Yeah.
But there's no way to ensure it if you hold on to this.
I mean, with Acolyte. Keeper, though, it would actually allow you to use the Acolyte to smash into the Keeper and then Battle Rage it, so you would at least get one draw kind of by proxy.
So I don't think that's worth it.
Yeah.
I think you just armor up here.
I mean, there's a chance that Dog wins, because this turn 7 is actually pretty sweet. But, I mean, Life Coach still has answers.
This is a cool play. So, his opponent just used Swipe. There's, like, little chance, and Wrath, there's little chance that he can answer this directly. And even if he does, he's giving up a big portion of the turn.
Yeah.
And can't develop Ancient of Lore. He's recognizing that this is, like, the turn that Druid wants to turn it around.
Mm-hmm.
With big draws.
But with that... that Shredder draw, it just makes the Swipe play much better.
Yeah, but Life Coach's play was definitely the right one, right? Because it forces the Druid to have the answer, and it's unlikely he does. And Dog just happens to have had a really good Emperor early.
I think the main answer there was actually Druid the Claw and Charge.
The Gift of the Fire War Axe?
Right, I mean...
Well, anything he plays does.
Yeah, that's the War Axe, of course.
And the Shredder gives better sticky minions, but he gets to keep Swipe.
Mm-hmm.
I think another argument to be made is that Life Coach's play just forces Druid into tough positions, even if he had really good options like Dr. Boom and Ancient of Lords. Like, well, I have Frothing Berserker out.
Mm-hmm. And I think you might consider Shield Slam here because you just won't have much armor later on, and your health is pretty precious.
Yeah, that sounds like a good. That sounds like a good play.
Yeah, and you have Execute to deal with bigger minions, so I too, gentlemen, am okay with that play.
Incoming Millhouse Mana Storm.
Is that the worst option?
It's pretty bad because it can push for damage as well.
What's another minion like for 2 mana that's annoying? Stone Skin Gargoyle.
Divine Shield garbage.
Yeah.
And Stealth.
Annoyotron and any like kind of a Gilden Stalker.
Like that.
Annoyotron.
Wow, really? That just happened.
Yeah, and that goes directly into the Acolyte for a lot of cards.
Yeah, in theory.
But not to mention that, well, I guess you did use one patron, but that's always liability versus patron.
Mm. What if you just drew the Claw and Wrath?
Yeah, save the Dr. Boom, because you can kill off your... I think you're right. Like, you don't want to let your opponent draw many cards.
You might just trade, like, into the 2-4 with the Drew the Claw in charge, and you Wrath the other one. That gives you... That forces the war to deal with the Divine Shield. You know, we've talked about this, but it's like the worst feeling ever.
A very back-and-forth game so far. This has been a really cool game, actually.
Considering the awful draw from Dog, initially, that ended up paying off.
It's not like Life Coach has had the most...
Life Coach is feeling the heat from Dog right now.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's right.
Oh, man.
And it's not just from Texas, either.
So much. Like, the Weapon Clog is... unfortunate, but I mean, it's going to compensate for the fact that he's going to have to smash his weapons repeatedly into the Annoyotron.
Well, he can take some damage because his opponent's on one card and he already used a Savage Roar, so it's unlikely he has combo.
Yeah,
I think he might have opportunities to set up like Deathbite, Whirlwind stuff. Yeah.
He might get like the
problem.
I think
you have to execute though.
Yeah, and it's going to get punished if he executes.
You can Shield Slam this first. I think execute's more valuable. So I think you can hit the Deathbite into
the
Annoyotron and then armor up Shield Slam the 4-2.
Don't you want to hit the 3 attack weapon into the Annoyotron and then Deathbite?
But then how do you trigger the Whirlwind effect? Unless you want
to
equip
it. I don't think you need to.
But then you can't draw with the Acolyte and then Battle Rage next turn.
Yeah, maybe setting up the Deathbite now would be better.
I know your inner value machine from Arena Crypt is going crazy right now. But
yeah.
I gotta admit, man, that's probably...
I think you're right. No. But I still wouldn't do it.
Especially with the Execute, right? Because the DOE can also deal with a bigger minion that the Dog plays.
I think you're totally right, but just
so he's saying he doesn't have Keeper of the Grove. This ends up being the right play, I think. It's like one of those plays that has a lot of payoff potential, and it does.
Yeah,
this is really big.
So in this case, I mean, this is pretty fine. Like the Death Bite.
I think you actually Death Bite and then Death Bite again.
No, you just have to attack the Annoyotron and then attack into the Dr. Boom and execute it. Unless you really want to get that double card drop.
I think I like Deathbite. Deathbite.
All right.
You probably get a 3 card Acolyte and you clear the board.
Right. Okay.
You can.
I could see that.
Oh, he's gonna Battle Rage and then do that?
You can't double Death Spite if you Battle Rage first.
No, I think he and...
I don't think that's in his plans. Maybe looking for another AoE.
I think he's anticipating for, like, or... yeah, some way to activate the...
Like a Whirlwind.
The Whirlwinds.
Yeah.
Or Inner Rage, or Slim, or... Maybe even Unstable Ghoul. Like, you'd be, like, okay hiding behind that.
Hmm.
I don't even mind, like, the double deaths, but...
A Whirlwind would be so insane. If he gets Whirlwind, he can actually drop Patron and Whirlwind.
He's gonna go for the double deaths by play. Crip, you're a genius.
Well, it's only marginally better than the other one.
Yeah, but he gets a guaranteed play, and it's not random. Like, what if things go wrong?
You get 3-card Acolyte, too, so that's nice.
We could use our confirmation bias to say that he would have not gotten anything, got the armor smith and stuff.
Yeah. It's easy to be right.
Taking that sweat off his brow.
Yeah.
Oh man. He works for that. So time. Intense.
Yeah.
Dude, like, even the way
I think Hearthstone just needs more life coaches. Just so people can see players like, you know,
if they're
panicking and sweating and thinking, oh god.
And then you can actually qualify for the Olympics.
If there's a reason to ever chess use qualified, didn't it?
I think it did.
I can never rationally justify 4K resolution, but to see the sweat beads on Life Coach's foreheads while he plays Patron, sign me up!
Yep. You know, Life Coach's like, wow, that's it.
That's all you got?
Nothing left.
Yeah. And then the Whirling Zap-O-Matic comes out unanswered.
Alright, well.
That should be...
It's Patron time. Oh.
Yeah, I'd probably just take the Patrons anyway. Is that an argument not to? I mean, I kind of like just Patron, Armorsmith.
Yeah, I think I like just play all the stuff.
Yeah.
And then just execute the Shredder, hope that whatever comes out is garbage.
I think I like Patron. Yeah, Patron with the executes.
You can Battle Rage instead of an Armorsmith, though.
Yeah, if you'd rather draw like three cards,
it's
I guess
three
that's
cards.
Fun. Oh, yeah, because you have your hero power. Yeah, your hero, sorry, being damaged as well.
There's also there is just Thoris in play as well, forcing your opponent to trade in and then getting like another.
What would Dog trade though? Would Dog trade?
Yeah, just because it's too much of a threat with what Thorsen can do, and it's very clear that Dog most likely won't be able to kill him over two turns.
Okay.
He needs to specifically hit like Ancient of Lore in two combo. That's like his two turn lethal. And it's still possible with this Wild Growth draw.
The Armorsmith, though, make that a little less likely, because the amount of armor that Life Coach is going to be able to stack...
Okay.
That's a piece.
Now we're talking.
Yeah.
Now, I think...
You might trade away the BGH. No.
There's 9 damage right now. He's at 23, so you put him at 14.
Yeah.
Even if you drew Savage Roar, assuming he clears the board...
And he armors up, you're pretty good.
Yeah, it wouldn't work.
Yeah. But the Pilot Shredder does stick onto the board, so it's very hard to remove everything.
What about Force of Nature, Hero Power to kill the Emperor, and you push for 10?
You push for 2 extra that way?
Yeah.
You take 5?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
But the problem is that he doesn't actually kill him the following turn either, because he only has 8 power on board. And he already did use 1 Savage.
The drawer, right.
Yeah, it's pretty unlikely to actually draw the other one.
I mean, do you play around Patron since you've already seen one as well, right? That's the other consideration. How much do I expect him to have it?
Oh, okay. He blinks.
All right.
He blinks. Life Coach seems happy.
Yeah, Life Coach is starting to take big control over this game.
Yeah, he's like, okay, this is it. This is it. Like, this game is on its way out. I've got it.
Okay.
Definitely, he's got it. There's no way he doesn't. That 2 armor per AoE per minion, that's going to be a bit too much for Dog to go through. I wouldn't be surprised to see Dog just concede here.
Yeah, he's just going to get an obscene amount of armor and draw a ton of cards.
8 cards. So that's 5 cards and 10 armor. Oh, 8 armor, excuse me.
Yeah, an extra 8.
10 if you armor.
Yeah, the thing is, with this many creatures on the board, with the patrons being so threatening, it's probably going to gain another like 20 armor before the armorsmiths actually exit the board.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. Does Commanding Shout keep giving armor if you keep getting AoE effects? Like,
no, you have to take damage.
Yeah, it's a little unfortunate.
When you're at 1 health on a minion, it just doesn't take damage.
Gotcha.
Oh, want to get some more?
Yep.
I think you might just Battle Rage again.
Oh, come on. Whirlwind's too nice.
Wait, no, you'd overdraw if you have that, right? Yeah, you don't want to do that then.
I don't see a Whirlwind here. I'm disappointed.
Ancient of Lore was good a turn
last
ago.
Turn, yeah. Is he still alive? Yeah, probably.
Just too much stuff there. Just way too much armor, way too many patrons.
Doug is very, resilient.
I think this is pretty good information too. Like two Force of Nature druids, although they have come back in style. It's just good info for the Nelum guys to get.
Oh, he only had like two cards left that battle.
So no wonder he doesn't want a battle rage. That would have been a really bad idea, guys.
Okay, well this. I've seen this, and I've seen the opponent at like 60 health with like a taunt, and then he's still dead. Now he only has 19 health.
Okay, can you kill him with just one frothing hit?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, most definitely.
Absolutely. Are you kidding?
Yeah, that's the goal. Like, don't kill him with the pages or anything else. Just whirlwind one more time and hit him with one frothing.
The triggers on this armor smith are basically rubbing salt in the wound.
Yeah, Dog's sitting here taking it all too.
I don't know about that. He just seems like
he's just whirlwind again. Yeah. Just be whirlwind. Yeah.
Oh. Okay, nah, he's putting him out of his misery.
That's it.
Oh, no. Not exactly.
Not completely.
Oh, yeah.
Almost.
Alright, so that wraps up the first game. Or second game, excuse me. And that's a tied series. Out.
That was a pretty good game, though. Honestly, I
that was really cool.
Yeah, Dog being able to clear out the first wave was not something I expected at all. It gave him... Usually Swipe is a dead card in that matchup, like the absolute worst card to have. It did some work.
I'm kind of curious if it would have made much difference if he'd use the Druid of the Claw to kill, I think, the 2/4 instead of the Swipe.
Oh,
that's a good question. Well, I think it would have gotten
so that he could use all the patrons to final turns.
Maybe.
Is that what you're thinking?
I don't know. It's really tough, right? There's just so many things that happen in between.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. RDU is not home, so Dice and Life Coach have to talk to him through the interwebs.
Yep. Well, it looks like their spirits are pretty good.
Yeah.
Still a lot to do. Uh oh. Trump in his notebook.
Trumps in his notebook. Two Trumps, one notebook.
Oh man.
Oh god.
Value.
No, not this movie. Please don't. I don't want to see this.
Yeah. Sounds like a good start of a pasta.
Two Trumps, one shirt.
All right. Well, let's analyze the classes here. Maybe we get a moment to see. So both teams with Paladin, both teams with Druid, both teams with Warlock. Only Valleytown bringing the Priest, and only Nylan bringing the Shaman.
Yeah, we still have to flip RDU and Dice. Like, their lineups are probably swapped, based on what we've seen, so...
Oh, there's no Hunter from Nylon, actually. That is...
Yeah, really they did that, too, in the very final weeks, and it was a very interesting choice, considering that...
Hunter had the best win right across the tournament, right?
Right, and they did again. I mean, it's really interesting, because I think RDU was the guy who brought Hunter a lot, and now they're not bringing Hunter. They chose Shaman over.
Well, I mean, I remember that week, right? That was their death, like, descent to hell. That week was the beginning of the descent to hell, where they just kept going down and down and down and down.
Yeah, they hit like sixth place or something.
Right, and then they had to climb back up through Satellite Redemption and everything. But eventually, they made it through.
I thought in the climb they didn't have Hunter, right?
In the climb they had it pretty frequently. It's at the very last week they just decided, oh, let's just switch it up, and it failed miserably. But it might have just like have been the Hunter. It might have been other things as well.
There has been also brave choices, like I think one team didn't bring Warrior one week as
Wow.
And then
I think I've seen that as well.
That was like I was like, whoa, that's really crazy brave. Like, I can't believe some of the courage that these guys have in terms of messing with the lineups. But that's partially what's cool. This matchup is definitely more diverse. We have almost every class represented outside of Rogue.
Now, in terms of the classes, how predictable do you think Kibler's Priest is?
Oh man, I don't know what could be in there.
It'd be cool if he just like brought the Undertaker Priest for good old times.
Goodness, oh wow, you know.
Yeah. As far as the other classes, I wouldn't put it past Trump to also bring Midrange Paladin as Strifecrit did.
I think he's also going to bring Handlock.
I think so too. I think he's been playing mostly Zoo in the tournament, hasn't he?
Yeah, he has.
But
he
I feel like Handlock is just better than Zoo right now. And it especially has like super hard counter matchups, which is what you want in a deck in a tournament format.
Yeah, I would assume that Trump's bringing Handlock, and then I would also say he's bringing Secrets Paladin. I say this because I think Monk convinced Trump that Secret Paladin's a good deck. Before, he was unsure, and he wasn't sure, but I think Monk like spent half an hour talking to him at PAX, and then Trump's like, okay, I'll bring it. So
yeah, but it does take some practice, too. I mean, we saw Eloise kind of make some like two turns ahead plays that ended up in her winning the game because of it. Mm-hmm. And I think these are actually pretty hard plays to see because the mid-range Paladin playstyle is so different from the aggressive one.
It does. And we'll see what RDU's Paladin first comes out. Mm-hmm. He's been playing aggressive Paladin decks almost all week. I mean, I feel like RDU's been playing aggro decks all week.
Yeah. I'd bet on Secret Valley because like when I was casting with him last time, he basically said... it was the first day after I think 6-0 just went with a really bad run with his Paladin. RD said, "What do you think of Secret Paladin?" He said, "I think it's, you know, tier 1. It's above Patron. I think in like 1 month everybody will rage about it." One day after the mm-hmm. event. So it was pretty interesting.
It's pretty interesting that Dog went out again, though. I mean, he's... Yeah. Yeah, it's Druid again, though. I mean, that can lose.
Against aggressive Paladins, though, I think Druid does a little bit better. But I still think it's tricky. The only thing is that you have to make sure to get the standard anti-aggro druid stuff, like the Keeper of the Grove. Darnassus Aspirant actually has helped a lot because it's like an early game play. And even if he plays Living Roots, that helps give some board control.
They play BGH too, which it looks, you know, idiotic to say, but Mistress Challenger always goes up to 98 in some board cases, right?
Mysterious Paladin.
Well, that's a double Keeper of the Grove. Keeper.
Oh, is that a mid-range?
Nope, no, it's
an Avenge. It's kind of Avenge and Repentance.
Oh, Repentance.
Okay. You got excited way too fast.
Well, it's Cockhammer. Cockhammer, I think, is not that frequent in the Secret Pally.
Sometimes you'll see it.
It's in there once in a while. Like, Eloise had it for
mm-hmm. Some people cut, like, one True Silver because they end up being...
Was it Eloise? I thought it was Strafford that played it.
Both had it.
Both had it. Okay. Yeah.
I remember because Eloise drew it, but she didn't need it for lethal. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
All right. I was mostly actually thinking about the willingness to play Dog again. That's
right. Okay. And that might be some reverse psychology thing.
But what do you think he was targeting with Druid?
With so many classes remaining,
it's not Shaman, that's for sure.
It feels difficult. It feels like this is their best chance to...
get the win in?
Yeah, get Druid's win in while it can't be targeted.
Mm-hmm.
If you have Mech Shaman, that's like bad for Druid.
Terrible.
Have,
yeah, there's like three decks on Nihilim's side that he's doing super well.
But then if you think Tice is playing...
Oh, wow. Competitive Spirit into Coin Muster. That's the dream.
Yeah. Assuming it can stay alive.
But look at the Druid's hand right now. Everything is staying alive.
Yeah. Well, except for one poor Silverhand recruit. He will bite the dust.
Mm.
But yes, you are correct.
I guess you can Avenge too if you want. Mm. Just want like one guy bigger.
You know what?
He's really thinking about that right now. Yeah. Like, do you want Competitive Spirit or Avenge?
Avenge is more damage, I think, because if you muster and then
right,
guys
but,
dies.
But if your opponent... Oh, it would be on turn 4. On turn 4, he could just wipe your board.
You go Avenge, turn 2, Redemption, Competitive Spirit, turn 3, Muster. You're like full crazy.
Yeah, let's just do that.
Yeah, let's play all the secrets. Sounds good. Yeah, this is probably one of the better classes to use this exact sequence, Competitive Spirit with Muster against...
Mm-hmm.
It's rare they'll ever have like an interface swipe. So. Wild Growth would work.
If you had Wild Growth into like a swipe.
Yeah.
I mean, there's answers to everything in Hearthstone, except Charging Frothings. But other than that, there's answers to everything.
Wow. Snipe. Right.
Snipe.
You
can't even do
misdirection.
Much.
Misdirection. Yeah.
Eye for an eye. Force the draw.
Right cards.
Yeah.
Force the draw.
Ice block.
Oh, you're right.
Vaporize.
Vaporize.
Great secret. It actually works out.
Okay.
Well, Druid is...
Tog's opening hands have been so bad.
Think about this, though, because he's curving into Keeper afterwards. Is it really that bad, if you think about it?
Well,
yeah, Avenge
and
Redemption
would
be pretty awful.
Spirit, so it's not as bad as it would be Avenge.
Yeah.
I think you just Avenge and Dude. I don't think you play Redemption.
This might not look very intimidating, but that damage is going to add up very quickly, considering that the building pressure is only going to increase with like Pilot Shredder.
Mm-hmm.
And the worst part for Dog is that Divine Favor. This is one of the few cases where it's actually going to punish him because he hasn't been able to ramp and, you know, empty the hand at all. Oh, that's a pretty good pickup for future turns. You could set up.
Yeah, he has the Keeper here.
Revenge.
Do you pilot a Shredder simply, or is
that... Oh, that's an interesting choice to play against Avenge on later turn, but I mean, you don't know if that's Avenge. That could That literally is anything.
Yeah, this is, for the moment, it could be Noble Sack. You play a Shredder and you get punished.
It could even be that Competitive Spirit.
Yeah.
Because you played it
right. The sequence. So if you play Shredder and it's Competitive Spirit, you're done. You just lose.
Well, the spell, you know what? I've never actually been faced with a situation where mm-hmm. I literally can't do anything. This is like, he's paralyzed. Usually against Secret Paladin, you can almost mash. If you mash them in the early game, you're fine. Well, but when they drop secrets...
Plane Keeper only loses against Avenge.
Against Avenge, yeah.
The flip side is, that's what he has.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you ever size the 1-1? Size the... Just set up a crazy swipe,
mm-hmm.
and that you don't risk running into anything that's dangerous.
I don't hate that. Well, you still lose versus Competitive Spirit.
Yeah. Yeah, you do.
Yeah. Alright. Well, he played into Avenge, so I guess Dog is not playing very well, right?
Well, it's kind just of working kidding. Out,
obviously,
though.
Yeah, obviously you can't do anything.
I mean, it's working out. If
I think statistically he made the best play. I think the keeper plays around
agreed.
All secrets except Avenge, and then Avenge comes, and then you're really sad.
But I mean, it's still fine, right? Because the swipe can take care of this if he doesn't trade. If he trades, the second keeper finishes off the...
Well, he gets like a 3-card Divine Favor, so that's pretty bad. Or he can even save Divine Favor, maybe get a 4-card Divine Favor next turn.
Well, what do you Divine Favor now?
You can't Divine Favor next round unless you draw a really early game card.
I don't think so. Like, the question is all about whether or not RDU makes the trade into the Keeper, or if he plays Shredder and goes face with a 5.
I don't think you go face for the 5. I think you're too because vulnerable swipe, to swipe.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
So whatever you do, you don't go face, I think. Well, he's thinking about it. So
I mean, it is a lot of damage to miss if you just end up hitting into this keeper, and your opponent has to have the swipe.
Yeah, would you have, the question is, would you
have
played it?
That's a bad swipe, though.
It's an okay swipe.
It kind of clears everything except for whatever comes out of the pile of Shredder.
Yeah, which is going to be a Whirling Zap-O-Matic.
We haven't seen that yet.
With Blessing of Kings.
It has to happen, yeah. And King is going to come
up
the top.
Oh my god.
Yeah. It always happens.
That's one-off lethal if it actually happens.
Oh my
but he's got Light's Justice. Yeah, that's like...
No, it's with Light's
next
Justice.
Next turn, he wouldn't have the extra durability even.
Oh, no, it's not one off. Though. It's 3 off. Alright. Well.
I think if you silence...
I like Dog trying to channel, like...
Do you ever silence the 5-4 and just, like, kill a 1-1?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, it looks okay.
It gives you better board presence because the problem with swiping is...
You still lose everything. You give him initiative. And
he has something on the board and a weapon. You don't have anything.
Yeah.
And you're going to have to start from scratch again.
I'd even consider just silencing and going face. You still have to win the game. Remember that part.
Right. You have to deal
damage. Yeah, but you have swipe. So is that your rationale? That
yeah.
You swipe?
You'll swipe.
What about kings? It doesn't matter. It's still another 1-1. All right. So, what does RDU decide to do? I mean, she'll juggler, mini bot, redemption. Kind
yeah,
of wonky,
I think you actually maybe...
Empty the hand, right?
Yeah, you want to empty the hand as much as possible. Because whatever you're doing is really hard to deal with. You're gonna play Mysterious Challenger on turn 6, and you're going to Divine Favor with your 2 draws in the meantime.
Yeah.
So he's going to trade, he's going to play the juggler, and he's going to try to lose his guy so redemption gets super value.
Yeah.
He might even kill off this Keeper of the Grove.
Nope.
I think you might just kill off your 1-1 anyway.
I would probably do that.
Yeah. All those redemption targets are reasonable. I mean, the Night Juggler is definitely...
It juggles off of itself, I'm pretty sure.
Really?
I think so, doesn't
that's
it?
That's sick.
Oh, no, it can't.
I'm not sure if sick or disgusting is what you're saying. Like, this would really hurt me inside.
No, it can't juggle off itself. What was I thinking? I think, like, Cultmaster draws off of itself or something.
Yeah, in some circumstances, when, like, the entire board is wiped and there's some kind of priority for the player.
Yeah. No, there's no way it can juggle off itself. I'm just saying nonsense.
Swipe looks like the only play. But it's even good. I mean, Force of Nature is also not too bad.
If you're talking about, like, the least bad play,
Force of Nature
is
probably
But... A lot
just
of them
don't
are pretty
kill that
bad.
Shielded mini bot first.
I think he's worried about Noble Sacrifice. That's probably his biggest thing. He's gonna find that it's essentially the same thing. Redemption comes out.
All right.
Try to kill it again.
Shredder.
So Father Shred.
I really hope it's two health or garbage. It's two health.
All right, so that's actually not too bad. The problem is the Mysterious Challenger is coming out right now. And yep. Without a BGH top deck, that's basically going to be like.
Yeah. No, he's gonna play his Dr. Boom.
Yeah, he's got Dr. Boom. He's also got like.
Only three secrets.
Wait, is one of them Repentance?
I don't think so. I think RDU might have cut them out. Avenge, he hasn't played a second Competitive Spirit,
and Noble Sacrifice.
Yeah, RDU was arguing for less secrets in the Paladin deck when I talked to him last.
Well, he's got the Shredders and the Divine Favor, and those are two conflicting cards, so you do have to kind of get rid of something else. But man, that Divine Favor is going
to
crush.
Dude, there's so many cards in the hand of the Druid.
Yeah, that's the thing. He hasn't been able to...
Oh, there is Repentance! Wrecked.
Consecration top deck. Doesn't matter. Divine Favor.
Oh, he's only running one Competitive Spirit then.
It's possible. Yeah.
No, it's certain.
Didn't he? Yeah, there's no way he plays more than one.
He played one early game.
Okay. Oh, do people play more than one?
Yeah, I've seen
them. Oh, okay. Interesting.
I've seen some lists where the only secret they have one of is Repentance.
Repentance, okay.
Alright, well, that Knife Joker has a chance to redeem itself. Or kill itself.
Oh my god.
There it is. There it is, and Dog is pissed.
Dog will have to go for like a Hail Mary swipe there, right?
This is gonna be a Hail Mary. It's almost like it's basically
there's
Doomsayer.
No
time.
Way.
It's Doomsayer Prayer.
Yeah, it's Doomsayer Prayer time. There's nothing else. Ancient of War, does that even solve the problem?
Well, you do get two chances at Doomsayer. Right?
Oh, right, with Redemption. You're right.
It's probably Redemption.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting.
But it's Avenge and Noble Sack, actually.
So, what are the
have
odds
we seen two
nowadays?
Redemptions? We saw one a lot
is
earlier.
Is it Avenge and Noble Sack?
I'm pretty sure it is.
What are the
we
odds
haven't seen
nowadays?
Noble Sack at all.
We did. There's one Noble Sack.
Okay.
Yeah. It's Noble Sack and one other one. Okay, well. I mean, it makes for quite a story if Doomsayer pops out here.
Explosive Sheep might do it. Yeah, Explosive Sheep does it with Swipe.
Yeah,
okay, so
two outs.
It's okay. It's actually like 2.5%.
Wait,
we've seen tournaments
with Unstable Ghoul almost.
Yeah.
Less likely things have happened.
Yeah.
Okay.
Get down. I think it will live.
Yeah. Oh!
What?
Oh, wait. What if it buffs it? Okay. What if it buffs?
Wow,
this guy.
5-3, get down.
I was wondering, what if it buffs the Power Shredder so you can't even Hail Mary the
I think you pretty much just go all in on it. Okay. I mean, do you try Ancient of War? Does that save you? So it tanks 5? You'd be alive, right? Theoretically.
It's still Doomsayer Sheep. Sheep still works.
Yeah. But, like,
but,
Ancient of War looks more consistent.
I think Ancient of War might be his best chance, Rob. Yeah. I think you're right, Noxious.
It's unfortunate for the viewers, but...
No, I mean, if you're rooting for Dog to win, you still want to do this. But the problem is, RDU just has to hit a True Sword Champion off the next six draws.
No, yeah. If he just needs enough weenie garbage.
Any juggles, yeah. Any amount of juggles.
I think he's got it, actually. I think just almost on board. It's
yeah,
it.
He's got
because he gets an
board.
Extra one off. He needs a creature that costs 4 or less.
He needs.
No,
two.
he has hero power. I think he just has lethal.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah, he just has lethal. He has lethal on the board without Divine Favor. That's lethal.
Yeah, with the juggle. You're right.
They juggle, dude.
So never showing the divine favor.
Play divine favor.
Yeah, good idea. Not showing the card.
Well,
to
they
the
can
opponent.
See the card.
Yeah, that's too late.
And they already won with the Paladin.
Right.
So Dog was hoping.
So really, RDU BM'd us.
Yeah. Okay.
Aww.
Yeah. He just doesn't want to.
I feel cheated out of the three. Yeah.
He didn't want to show more of his cards.
More of
Dog
his deck,
looks like a
try hard to you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh wow!
Wow, Amaz.
Amaz giving him some comfort. It's like it's okay, Dog. Like it's not. It's okay to get benched. It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
Just I mean, two losses in a row right at the start of the match is not really a big deal.
Like, Julio is amused. Look, he's laughing at Dog. You do see that?
It's only one of your teammates. Has
high
to get
five
away.
From hype.
it was a low five to be fair.
It was.
Amaz, very,
okay,
very accommodating. Like here you are.
It's okay, Dog. You're still handsome and good.
The Chinese hospitality.
And good at Hearthstone.
Hmm.
Oh my
god.
This has got to be the most humiliating moment I've ever seen.
That's right. Here at the Archon House, we treat people
very nicely.
Like they're humans.
Yeah. We give them like good breakfast, but then dog food.
Well, that wasn't exactly how it went to coin a plan. Value Town, I guess their notebook's not really helping them out. So they got to go back to the drawing board. Now it's just up to Kibler and Trump.
Mm-hmm.
But the series just started. It's 2-1.
Yeah,
it's 2-1, but you don't want to start this way.
I think if you had, like, let's say hypothetically you had to get a player benched and we had no choice, I think in the very beginning of the series it's the least damaging.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Kibler might play Freeze. What does it have for bad matchups? I guess the Mage from Life Coach. Life Coach tends not to play Freeze, so we're expecting some kind of tempo. I've seen him play Mech.
Why doesn't he play Freeze? I think it'd be a great deck for Life Coach.
Yeah,
he likes playing tempo. I think he just likes playing tempo Mage too much.
Yeah.
Life Coach is really weird. I always think he likes really complicated and advanced decks. But I think he just likes really powerful decks. That's all.
Okay.
He likes Handlock because there's like always like relevance to do stuff. Like Tempo Mage, Mech Mage. Mm-hmm. Like that was what he used to play back in the day. In fact, Life Coach had this really crazy Mech Warrior back in the day.
Oh, goodness.
I tried that for like three games.
And he actually had a winning record. It was like a 60% win rate in tournaments. And he's played like, you know, 8 or 9 games of it. So. Wow.
Nobody else could actually make it work.
Everybody else tried and just failed. Did that piece of garbage 1-3 make the cut?
The Warbot? Yeah. It was a staple.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The Warbot was a staple.
Yeah, you can... It was like in one game.
You laugh, man. But it was pretty good.
Yeah, you're like in a rage rampage, man. Like, you can't...
What?
I don't think he did that, but I think
cool he's, that's a good follow up though.
Yeah.
What does that even make the card? A 4/2. It makes it a 7/5.
Yeah, it's a pretty big man. Oh, it's +1 attack, right? It gets. Mm-hmm. So you enrage and then you get plus.
Yeah, five. It's 7/5.
It's pretty crazy. Yeah.
All right. Well, back to the relevant part of Hearthstone here.
Priest.
Probably Priest, but again, you have to consider the fact that if you win with Priest, again, you're in that situation where you don't have evenly distributed check marks.
Yeah.
And that makes it so you kind of run into that bench issue again.
Sure.
And again.
So, for all intents and purposes, Value Town only has Trump, basically.
Yeah, I think playing the Paladin here is okay. It's pretty good against most decks here, unless Life Coach is playing Tempo Mage.
Yeah.
The thing about Priest is for the exact reason that you mentioned, Crypt, plus the fact that I'm pretty sure we can put Tice on Handlock.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what it's going to be. So I like the Paladin here from Trump.
Yeah.
Do you expect mid-range mostly, or did he really get sold on a secret?
Actually, I think mid-range is better against Handlock, by the way.
The mid-range Paladin?
Yeah.
I think it's debatable. I think Divine Favor makes a huge difference because you will often dump the hand.
It's not in every Pally deck.
It's not in every Pally deck. But Pally in general just has a lot of tools against it. If in mid-range, you have Aldor Peacekeeper to reduce all those Giants' attacks to one. You have Equality so you can just push through any big wall.
You're in Silence these days.
You have Silence, and your big threats late game can carry you enough because they're flirting with disaster with the Molten Giant.
It's kind of a weird thing, though. I think Paladin counters Handlock really hard, but if you play Demon Handlock...
Speaking of that, that looks like a Zoo deck from Dice.
Zoo Boys.
With Divine Shield, it's actually giving him a little bit more like breathing room against the Secret Pally deck as well.
Kind of. Still kind of stinks against Muster for Battle, though.
Yeah, Muster for Battle is just too strong, really.
And Trump has Avenge into Muster.
And Competitive Spirit.
Yeah, the Competitive Spirit is pretty valuable too, but one of the biggest problems of Zoo is that fundamentally it wants to trade a lot because it needs the board control. And then Avenge just makes trading impossible to usually do it cost effectively unless you have an early board lead. Competitive Spirit is also valuable, but it's usually you trading on your turns, which Paladin excels at anyways. So I think the Avenge into the Muster for Battle is going to be nasty. And Tice is going to have to...
Yeah, he's not playing against Druid. He can kind of assume that he can take out a few more of the cards.
I wonder if Trump does this thing of, like, not mulliganing until the last second to not reveal information.
That's the giant.
Oh, that's pretty good against Muster for Bestie.
Yeah, turns out it's actually playable.
Sea Giant.
He's going to go for the Dream.
So.
Ooh, that seems really risky. Hmm. Like, if Dice just plays a card.
Yeah.
It triggers on one dude.
Well, he's going to play Muster for Battle.
I mean, the Egg plus Power Overwhelming could give him the potential to...
Yeah, exactly.
To trade two guys and then waste the Competitive Spirit on a single target. Well, there's a chance that Trump decides not to play it if there's only one target.
Yeah, so he tossed away Avenge.
Right, and kept Competitive Spirit because he wanted to get a Muster play, but...
Oh, you know what? Wait.
What?
Maybe he thought that Tice was going to play Handlock, so that's why he got mind gamed by it.
Yeah.
So he's like, I'll keep competitive.
I think you're absolutely right.
But you saw the artist wire. You can't think it's Handlock. Oh, you mean for the Mulligan?
No,
okay,
for
sure.
Mulligan.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. And then he was forced to play competitive because that was his only.
Right.
Well, he went second, so you're right.
Mm-hmm.
It was the only thing you could do.
Is there an argument for just holding on until Sea Giant does something?
Well, now you're still afraid of Avenge. Like, it's the
no,
mind
you're not.
Game there.
No, Avenge, no, Avenge is awesome.
Avenge is great.
Avenge is the best thing ever.
Because of power overwhelming.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I guess so.
You're going to trade. You're going to find out exactly what secret it is. And you're going to be wondering if you should power overwhelm at that point.
Yeah. I guess
wow, this is so scary. Because on the one end, you have Thais, being able to get a 4-4. Trump doesn't have a good response. And the worst part for Trump is that the hand from Thais is actually going to be big enough. I mean, small enough that Divine Favor might not see play ever. It's already like something you don't expect against Zoo, but sometimes it gets stuck with clunky Doomguard.
Yeah, that's the issue with Divine Favor. It's so strong, but usually need it the most in decks that it's going to be worthless.
Right, and terrible.
Yeah, you're right, the more I think about it as well. One thing that's also like an interesting side effect is that the more he does this, the weaker Sea Giant... Well, not weaker, but the longer it takes for Sea Giant to come out.
That's kind right. of okay, though. I mean, Knife Juggler into Avenge, and you can kill the Voidwalker.
The Avenge
over the Redemption?
Should be...
Yeah, it's definitely over Redemption.
I would play Avenge way more often than...
I'm just trying to think, like, what happens if...
What if it's Noble Sack, right?
Like, what do you expect your opponent to play on a 4? It's usually Implosion.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you play Knife Jugglers and Avenge...
He kills your entire board,
yeah,
and like, he has a bunch of 1/1s, and you have two silver.
I think there's no way around that.
Yeah.
So I think you have to go with the best play.
Yeah.
Unless you really want to risk the fact that the 2/1 might just do nothing.
Well, it's not the 2/1 won't do anything. It's like he almost like a killer Knife Juggler,
yeah.
And then it'll buff and it'll trade with his 4/4.
Yeah.
But we know that that's not the case at all. Trump will have to face the Void Caller instead, which doesn't have any follow up apparently.
It's still a pretty decent play. I mean, you really just want to dump your hand. I think if you dump your hand with the... Oh, that's good.
Oh,
that's really good.
What a great top deck.
Not bad.
Yeah, you just want to empty your hand as much as possible because you know when you're both out of cards, you are going to win as the Warlock.
Yeah. So there's a lot of ways to interpret this card. It could be Noble Sacrifice, so that way the Nightfucker stays alive. It could be Avenge number 2 because of the sequencing.
Well, Noble Sacrifice doesn't really affect the way you attack, so you just don't play around.
Yeah, I think you're still going to lose your guy.
And of course, there's the Redemption, which we know is here.
Avenge.
Oh, it's the Avenge, excuse me, you're right.
You know what we need? We need, like, this new application for Hearthstone Spectator Mode with all the secrets displayed, like, clearly on the side.
He still cannot draw from Divine Favor, which means I think you might even want a True Silver. Oh.
He's gonna keep the 2/1 alive, I guess. He's gonna have 2/1/1, well,
yeah.
2/1/1s. Yeah.
So he doesn't want to trigger the void caller.
Yeah. He doesn't want to trigger it. Makes sense,
mm-hmm.
I think.
Yeah, I like that as well because I think he's afraid of what the void caller can pull out. It seems like his opponent has like a couple of cards that might be clunky.
Nah, Divine Favor might
draw.
It's
very clunky.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to play this.
Wait. No, yeah, never mind.
Yeah,
no.
Divine Favor is gonna get really good value here.
Yeah.
Because I think you have to tap. You can't risk playing nothing here. And right now you're playing nothing.
You might play...
Void Caller?
Yeah, would you without a Demon in hand?
Now that you know that's Redemption and it's Noble Sacrifice, it's a lot more minions onto the board.
Yeah, you're still one man away from getting the Dream. But...
Oh, that's so... That is so... That's such a tease. Like,
yeah.
Sea Giant can't come out until one more mana.
It's really nice, though. Really nice that he made that play. That's hard to do. And now Trump can basically draw one card if he wants.
Yeah, and now he's also exposed to having to deal with the Void Callers. I think the reasoning is I can't actually play around with the demons coming out, so I'll just ignore them and let him trade if he wants.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Drawing one card's still better than nothing. In this case, he's just going to try to aggro his opponent down, I suppose.
Yeah.
If Slice actually had one more mana, he could play Doctor Broom and Sea Giant.
Oh, right, because the three minions that come out with Dr. Boom.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good life tap turn.
Oh my god!
Oh
my god!
That
is so gross!
Nuts.
Brutalized!
He's gonna pull out the Mal'Ganis. He could have pulled. Oh man.
This is going to be devastating for Trump.
He doesn't even get a divine favor now.
Yeah.
Denies the divine favor as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
Trump is just. He literally just eye rolled a little bit, like, oh, yeah, I expected Mal'Ganis, you know.
That was unbelievable.
Yeah.
I also really like how Trump's sitting in a posture that, you know, squints the eyes of the t-shirt.
And I've been trying not to mention that the whole time, but I have been aware of this for a while.
He, like, scrunches his face like he's really stressed. And all
that's what actually creeps me out of that shirt, is, like, when it starts moving and having, like, facial expression.
Oh, he's back. Nope. Now he's coming.
He doesn't want to talk. Shut him up.
All right. Well, Trump's going to need a miracle to come back now.
Yeah, it's not looking likely. Without equality...
Can't even do that. You can't even kill off Mal'Ganis.
No, you can't do anything. You're dead. You're just dead.
Yeah.
I like Tyson Zulist, honestly. Bringing back Sea Giant in the metagame, like, infested with Paladins, kind of makes sense.
It's the mid-range Zoo that has a lot of benefit off Implosion. Implosion gives you more minions for Sea Giant, which gives you better demons
for
Mal'Ganis.
Well, that's a huge, huge game for Nihilim, because it's not... It's not like they just win a game, right?
Right.
It's they win a game and Valiant doesn't win a game, which means Dog is still benched. And if Trump plays again, then they isolate Kibler.
Yeah.
It's like
that's right.
Crazy bad.
And then Trump and Dog are in the bench.
Yeah.
Together.
Wow.
Wow. Like, he could even play Dr. Boom in his board and have just ridiculous power. Even if he couldn't win that turn.
Yeah.
What a game. That's 3-1. For Nihilim right now, and things are not looking very good for Value Town at all.
Yeah,
I would consider just burning the notebook.
Yeah,
it's
you know
not
what?
Doing any work. It's
doing the same exact thing as it would otherwise.
Yeah. I need to get another glimpse of that trophy there in the middle. Pretty good stuff.
And before somebody runs away with it?
Yeah, I think it's pretty easy to track down who stole that one, though. Yeah. I don't think there's another one of those.
No.
No, not yet.
There's no GPS install, so I could do it.
Yeah.
That's what you think. Until you find out that they've already put GPS in all of us.
Okay.
All right, well, here are the standings. Nihilim basically has the dream where it's one checkmark per player. This is the three-win dream right now.
Right. Yep.
And Dog is benched. Trump is on one loss. So even though he has the most flexibility, it's a huge gamble to actually play, because if you play, you isolate Kibler.
Right.
Who's playing a fairly predictable deck, by the way.
Right, but the thing is, the deck that Kibler is playing is sort of okay against...
it's most of
I mean, if it's Mech Shaman from RDU, I guess
it's
might pose
priest,
a problem,
priest
but
is pretty good
fine.
I think you just play Kibler, honestly.
Dragon Priest especially, I think.
I think you just play Kibler.
They're leaving.
Yeah.
Which means I think Trump's staying on.
Oh, is that right?
Well, I think Trump's really trying to win to free Dog here. I think also Dog... being benched and Life Coach not playing Mage confirms he's not playing Freeze Mage. Because the Druid and the Warrior are benched.
Yeah, they're
like,
benched.
Those are the decks that you're afraid of as the Freeze Mage. It's got to be the Tempo Mage. And I think if Life Coach won't play because he wants to catch Dog as soon as he gets unbenched, his decks would be good against it. So it's RDU and Tice really now.
Yeah, but the Mech Shaman, if you're expecting Trump, let's say, to go out, you might not want to run that just because it's kind of hard to fight for the board sometimes.
Isn't a Tempo Mage good against the Paladin, though?
Yeah, it's
pretty good. It depends. I think it's all about, like, if you have that Flame Waker stuff to be able to land. It's like Zoo. Like, part of the reason why Tice's version of Zoo fell out of popularity is because sometimes the draw curve is very awkward.
Yeah.
Like, you have so many high-cost minions, and then you just don't have, like, the
Implosion, let's say, to set it up.
Or
right.
You don't even have, like, avoid turn 1 through 3 play, because sometimes it's just awkward. And that could be the case of the Mage as well. I'm predicting a Druid coming out here from Tice, but
likewise.
I think Shaman also has room to come out, because if Trump is going to queue up again... And he's playing like Handlock. That's Mech Shaman.
Goodness, that would be the best.
Of course, it could be just mid range Shaman, and we're just like completely caught off guard. It could be Zeus Shaman, and that's what I hope.
I wanted to see something like that from RDU.
I know RDU has in the past tended to play like cutting edge decks.
Yeah.
Like, oh, this is good. Nobody's playing this.
Yeah.
I'm playing this.
Yeah.
Let me surprise
but
him with.
At the same time, he's played a lot of Mech Shaman.
I mean, in ATLC has been pretty much a trademark.
Yeah.
Shaman has been playing nothing but Mech Shaman pretty much in ATLC. I think we might have seen like one mid-range early in the league, but that was it.
Yeah, so I was thinking Druid or Shaman against Handlock, but Trump could also flip the switch and just go straight for Zoo.
He's been playing a lot of it.
Yeah. However, I think if he's keeping Patron in mind and he's playing Paladin, I think Value Town might be leaning towards playing the Handlock. But that's interesting because it feels like most people are leaning towards Zoo for so far. Yeah. People don't. We haven't seen a Handlock yet.
I think Zoo is still pretty okay to handle Bateman. Like, it's not going to be an amazing win rate, but it's not completely impossible.
I'm kind of hoping we'll see some Handlock. I think it's a pretty strong deck, and it's nice to see it. It's a very strategic deck that Trump now knows how to play pretty
because... well. So you're rooting against Trump?
Yeah.
Because Druid would be pretty strong.
I'm rooting in the favor of everyone's entertainment.
Oh, well, it isn't the Handlock. It could be Demons.
Mid-range, right?
It looks like it's faster.
Yeah, the Voidwalker is pretty indicative of a faster Warlock.
Thais has got a pretty good hand there. I mean, it's curving, naturally, no matter what. And he could ramp up a little bit for free.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with being on the coin on Darnassus Aspirant is that if your opponent can magically deal with it,
you're out.
Through Abusive Sergeant Sorcery, you just have no turn two play.
Yeah.
So you can coin it out in anticipation for Shade of Naxxramas, but then you're really sad with it.
Yeah, you might also play it on turn two like you would Wild Growth, say, in some cases.
So. But then you're also in this weird
position. Then it's even more likely to die.
Right,
then.
More likely to die.
I think you have to coin it. I think you just have to take the risk.
You should coin every time, but it's one of those things where Thais is going to really hope that Savage Roar turns into Innervate or something else.
Wild Growth would be pretty okay.
Wild Growth is okay.
Yeah, but there's so much ramp in the hand, though.
He actually throws away the Pilot Shredder as well because he's just not that confident in this Aspirant to stay alive.
Well, so far, I mean, if there's an Abusive Sergeant coming up, he'd be right.
Yeah, he pushed really hard for something that wasn't the Shredder.
I think you'd even powerful on the future of the...
Would you just coin out Shade or you play the Aspirant here? Because you wouldn't even kill a Voidwalker. You'd have to hero power turn 2, which again at least makes your turn 2 relevant.
You coin it out.
Yeah, you have to coin it out.
You coin it out for sure. The other...
I was thinking about it.
The only problem is that you don't know what Warlock...
he's playing.
Well, sorry, you don't know exactly what kind of Warlock he's playing, and if it's like a faster curving Zoo, then you have to definitely peg it onto him, but if he's like playing a slower Zoo, then yeah.
Well, here comes the Knife Juggler. It's,
is he gonna kill the Shade? At some point.
I don't think so.
No, it's just...
The implosions, man. When they implosion and kills my Shade, I get so mad.
Yeah, I've heard, I was listening to you last time when you were having a discussion with Ben Brode, and somebody was asking you, do you rage when you play Hearthstone? And apparently you get those rage moments.
Yeah,
it's kind of nice to know that, right?
Yeah, you know, the only time I won't rage when I lose is to cast your Jabberino.
Oh, right.
You expect the result already, right? You know what's going
to
happen.
That's right.
But you seem to know more stuff than even I do. Like, just Jessica Artrua, I have no idea.
I sincerely doubt that, Noxious. And I will bet you $5,000.
Nicely done. Well played.
I think here you actually don't want to attack. You want that thing to trade for the... You want to force Trump to trade the Knife Juggler into it. Because it is an extremely high priority target.
That's right.
Yeah, and the more...
Oh! Does that punish him?
Not exactly.
Yeah.
Do you play...
It might.
It could.
If the juggle hits the 2/3, 1 out of 3.
Yeah, it's not guaranteed.
But then your...
You got to play on curve.
Your doggy gets killed.
And even if it hits the Shade, right? It's still fine, because the Shade is then more likely to die down the line.
There's still some redemption in the Direwolf Alpha with the imps that spawn with the Imp Gang.
The Imp Gang boss, right.
So it's not like you lose the value that you would otherwise get.
Oh, that's a bit of a clunky turn, but you kind of knew it playing Aspirant.
It's
you
the
know
risk.
It.
I don't think... I think you just pass.
Yeah.
Well, you hero power.
I might attack into the Voidwalker to just kill it with Keeper on the following turn. Maybe there's an argument for that.
I kind of like that, actually.
Yeah, Shredder looks just so much stronger that I don't know. It's just... There's a multiple lines of play you can make.
If you kill the Voidwalker and then he trades into the Shade, then...
Swipe is better.
Swipe is better.
Shot, yeah.
Keeper the Grove is better.
Everything's better, pretty much.
Shredder is about the same.
Do you want to...
The problem is Defender of Argus on the other end is really punishing. So if Thais...
Oh, he just silenced, though.
Yeah, but
get a really nice.
If you don't do anything, and he plays Defender of Argus, and it's like a 2/4. And
he just silenced the Imp Gang boss, and then kill the 2/4 taunt with your Ben 4/4.
Yeah, I suppose.
Ferdinand's not convinced.
It's still the same effect either way.
Yeah, you kill the Voidwalker.
Because you kill the Voidwalker either way.
Yeah.
So Trump picks up the Hunter Creeper, and I think now he can just set up to make sure that he can use the Direwolf Alpha effectively.
Yeah, the Direwolf
has been placed in the Rubian Egg, though.
You know, I don't know if you want to play it beside the Haunted Creeper. I think you play the Haunted Creeper on the other side of the taunt here. Ooh.
All right, so he wants the 1/1s if they spawn to actually spawn with, near the egg. So
yeah, you want the 1/1s to spawn near the edge.
Yeah.
But you want the egg in the middle for flexibility. Because you might want to doggy one side or the other. I think that's the idea anyway.
Yeah, I think Imgang boss, no matter what, we agree goes in the end though, right? Because of the way the
1/1 spawn. The way the 1/1 spawn, yeah.
So this is some breathing room. Your opponent loaded up only one power onto the board, so I think you can take your turn developing Shredder. You don't have to silence, but I would not blame him for feeling the need to use Keeper to go to silence the egg here.
Yeah, because I think when you swipe, if you want to kill the Nerubian, you are enabling all sorts of things, right? Yeah. You're enabling the Imgang boss. And then.
Yes, now there is the other side of that. Shredder is the much better tempo play as well, but it does play into the Nerubian egg. And then you have multiple targets you want to swipe, which makes it very difficult to get effective trades.
Yeah, silencing the egg seems like the safer play.
Yeah, you get eventually 4/4 with the value. That thing's getting triggered somewhere or another.
And with that Iron Beak Owl is the right play, because he would have silenced the Shredder
and gotten the 4/4. Basically won the game.
Alright, so there's you can take the trade that's offered and lose the egg, which I guess is not really that big of a loss. You like get an extra 1/1, but do you really want to do that?
I think you lose the egg and then you attack with Imp King boss.
Yeah. Perfect. Oh, nice.
Perfect.
Really perfect.
Doesn't get much better than this.
And you get to keep the Iron Beak Owl, so that way you can get past the inevitable taunts.
Mm-hmm.
Your opponent might not have many taunts, but you can guarantee that there's probably like Trooper or the Claw and other relevant minions.
I feel like Swipe is about to hit and do a lot of work. Like, the next two turns could be Swipe turns if you want them to, and literally like play them back to back.
Yeah, this is directly to play or into Druid the Claw, so you can trade easily.
Yeah, playing the 4/2 there.
The swipe?
What does I already it do? Know if it's the good.
It doesn't do much now, but the thing is, the second swipe makes everything so much nicer. Man, you just play the Drake.
Drake swipe but it's would like, be devastating on this
part. Yeah. Shredder looks like it's actually fine now.
I think I like the Shredder over the Drake.
Yeah. It's gonna die anyway, from your perspective, so.
It trades too cleanly. The problem with the Drake is that it dies to the
4/2, right? A one drop, so.
Yeah, I mean, and the Shredder, the 3 health kind of acts as 4 health.
Could you just swipe the Direwolf Alpha? Oh, wow, he's gonna do it.
I guess.
I mean, what it does is it sets up the sickest swipe on the following turn. And you're pretty much guaranteed to just clean the board completely.
I don't know about that.
No?
You know, attacking here seems dubious just because You can afford to take that one extra damage, and you're going to swipe things down anyways.
Yeah. Alright.
That's a lot of damage. Do you think he's just going to fall on the burst? There's no reason not to here. He's going to put his opponent on the back.
Yep. You get a value discard on your Doomguard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just the owl. If only it was Fist of Draxxus.
But, unfortunately, the Shade won't die by attacking to the Doomguard. After the swipe was played, right?
Right. So he can swipe hero power down the 1/1 and the 6/6 kills the Doomguard.
Right.
And there's no 1/1 from the
the Imgang boss.
The Imgang boss, right.
That's actually a really great... Actually, wait, is there even one from the Haunted Creeper? Oh yeah, it triggers after. You're right.
Yeah. You can't really stop that.
But I don't think you want to play for efficiency here. I think you need to just be desperate and stay alive. You're at 7 HP.
Yeah, you have to swipe, right? Like, you just swipe the Voidwalker and just kill the Doomguard with a Shade, and then finish up with 1/1.
Yep. That's the only play. Value or tempo, that's the only play.
Yeah, I think it's just too optimistic to let the Doomguard survive.
You don't.
Yeah, there's absolutely no reason to.
I agree.
Alright, so there's a 1/1 on the board, and back-to-back PO, or with another Doomguard.
I guess you can Wild Growth if you want.
You'd be dead to the Doomguard.
The other Doomguard.
Second Doomguard.
He gets 2 draws at it. You're right about that. Alright.
But there is Ancient of Lore to keep him in. The only problem is the Warlock You start climbing back onto the board pretty effectively. That's still two turns away, though.
Void Tear. That is pretty worthless, but you gotta play it. You gotta have something on the board.
Yeah, put a 3-3. Forces a Wrath to be as
different than Mind Control Tech.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a pretty big opportunity for Druid to climb back in here.
Looks like you'll have to take a face hit, though. And I don't know if you can just heal.
I think
that, but there's too low tempo and you don't have swipe anymore.
Can you afford not healing, though? Like, what do you do instead? Because you're not.
You could do Shade Shredder.
Do you threaten your opponent with lethal? You're not on 9
No, but you combat the board a bit more, and if you heal later on.
Okay, so on the following turn, you'd heal?
Yeah. Mm.
Alright, I can see that. Oh, wow, that's actually gonna. Oh, my goodness, it's Mal'Ganis.
I mean. Probably it then.
Well.
Not quite. I mean, there's still a Wrath. There's still probably two Wraths, right? So the Azure Drake could get one of them, and that would be enough to slow down the.
Huh.
Wow.
Yeah, he has the Azure Drake into Wrath to not lose.
Yeah, but it feels like he's drawn through a big portion of his deck already, so it wouldn't surprise me if he hit the Wrath.
Yeah, he's drawn quite a few cards. But that's not the one he was looking for.
And well, that's gonna do it. Should be it.
That is absolutely it. Trump's gonna take it and relieve Dog off the bench.
That's very important because he also avoided the bench for himself.
Yeah, he dodged the bench, which I think is the biggest thing. And Trump seems really relieved, and so does his shirt. Wow.
His shirt has been optimistic this entire game.
Yeah, he's like, Trump, keep your chin up. You know.
I wonder if Trump talks to his Trump W shirt and asks him what he thinks.
I think the Trump shirt talks to Trump.
Yeah, it's hard to tell.
I think it's pretty easy to tell.
I just want to see that shirt after, like, few laundry loads when it's just cracked and everything.
Oh goodness.
That's Trump. The catch, Trump. He never washes.
Oh
I see.
So that way it stays forever. Yeah.
That's value.
That's the catch for Trump.
Yeah.
Never waste
the shirt. Maz, our host of the ATLC.
Oh, you did it. You're off the bench.
We'll pull him off.
Look at the excitement. He's like, God, that seat sucks. All right.
What's hilarious is Dog literally comes off that bench to talk to them and the team and then just goes back to the bench.
Right, yeah.
So the bench is just symbolism for Dog's incapabilities in the beginning of the season.
Well, it's actually more than symbolism if you think about it, because he's not part of the team discussion on who they should play.
Right.
Unless Kibler sits on the chair right in front of him and just turns around and talks to him.
But then you'd have to go up and down through the house to
That's a long time to talk.
Because they're playing upstairs and the bench is downstairs.
Yeah.
So they have some downtime.
So you're saying they lose 15 seconds climbing up the stairs.
But, there's a real impact.
3 calories.
But the thing is...
Probably more than that for some of them.
If you rush, if you're stressed, I think.
What?
Oh, wow. I think so. Like, there's... Like, the bench rule doesn't seem to matter too much if you can actually, like, dodge it from this point on. If Dog ends up going out with a patron, he can actually... I would say, like, how does it fare versus Tempo Mage nowadays? Like, does it just fall flat on its face?
Patron versus Tempo?
Yeah.
Well,
it's interesting to me.
The Tempo Mage is very good if it can snowball some stuff out early, because it can actually disrupt the weapons and stuff.
We've seen the patron warrior kind of tech against the more aggressive decks these days. Like, I think all the patrons we've seen so far have had 2 Fiery War Axes.
And the Shield Box and the Shield Slam as well.
Exactly.
You're right.
The big problems are, like, when they get Mana Worm out, and then they have Mirror Image, and then it's
you're right.
Oh, wait, like, you'll never get to my minions.
No, it's like...
Double Divine
Mana Worm, and then Sorcerer Apprentice, Mirror Image, Coin Frostbolt. You know, we're done.
Yeah, exactly. And then you have to have, like, Slam and then Execute and stuff in order to kill it off.
Yeah.
I still want to see the Breeze from Kibler, honestly. They're probably going to
come out. It'll come out. There's no way it won't come out.
Well, there's some way where it won't come out.
Well, it'll be, like, one of those things where, like, if RDU is the shot, like, Shaman's the last class, and then the Priest will definitely come out there.
Yeah, all right. But they could just get totally wrecked and it would never see play.
Well, now that the Handlock is out of the way, Shaman got a lot weaker. A lot weaker.
Well, we still don't know what Shaman it is, but if it is Mech, definitely.
I feel like the Shaman is always, like, pretty good against the Patron Warrior.
It's pretty decent. Right. And Druid as well. So it could be one of those things where they anticipate Dog going right back in. They can cube Shaman to snipe it. I think their safest pick is
Druid again?
Actually, the Mage, I think, from Life Coach. Overall, in terms of win percentages,
with just Patron? You beat Druid? Priest is a bit, you know...
I think Priest kind of owns you.
Overall, yeah.
Priest's just, like, the creatures are too big.
Yep. All right, Druid again from Thais. Well,
good thing that they avoid that then.
Yeah.
But then they risk getting benched here.
Right. And Thais would see the, I guess, the wooden bench.
I guess so.
Yeah.
Now, Kibler's been known for his dragons. That's why there's one on his shoulder from other games and all the rest. And he certainly likes the dragons in Hearthstone. He tries to make them work. Even in Blackrock Mountain.
He's tried way too much. Before Dragon, like Blackrock Mountain,
he was trying when it was... Like, Blackrock Mountain came out, and people were like, okay, let's play dragons. And then 1 week later, like, let's not play dragons.
Yeah.
And Kibler was still playing dragons.
Right. He was like, let's make dragons work. And he tried everything from Dragon Mage to Dragon Priest to Dragon Pally, Dragon, like, everything.
Right.
Yep.
Pretty cool. But his dream has come true, and there's only going to be more tools, I think, for dragons in the future, because Blizzard seems to want to support the archetype, so...
Mm-hmm. Well, I think just naturally, just, I mean, there's dragons in World of Warcraft that haven't been released in Hearthstone yet.
Yeah.
They might just be, like, you know, 9-mana... You know, terrible cards that have way too much stats and get BGH'd and never see play ever again. But there's still going to be more of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
That's well, funny. I feel like almost every dragon has had some relevance at one point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the argument was Nozdormu, like,
but Nozdormu had some pretty dominant strategies.
Yeah, we both know about that.
I think it's like the best strategy in Hearthstone that ever came about. Yeah. Still more fair than Patron.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah, still more.
It's like the definition of non-interactive. You can't even have your turn.
Right.
You can if you're really fast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I learned that if you played Nozdormu and then three jousters, you actually skip your own next
turn. Yeah, it's not a good idea.
Oh. Wow. You went really far down the rabbit hole to research this.
Well, you tried.
No, I just played it. I played one too many.
Oh.
And then I just went back my opponent's full turn. I'm like, damn.
Mm.
Kibler's deck currently, like, we see no mulligan number one. This hand is pretty gorgeous, I think, and there's no dragons yet, so
could be, but all these cards aren't on the dragon deck, right. So it's still pretty certain in my mind that there is a dragon priest.
Yeah, how does Druid fare against it? Is it able to contest?
It's hard to deal with all those guys, I think.
Yeah. I think it's even more dependent on it was before. So the way Druid could beat priest, a lot of people felt like Druid was good against priest because you could seize the early tempo.
Wow,
that's Wrath into Dr. Boom.
Yep, that's pretty effective, and that's early game tempo.
Pretty effective. Okay, sure.
But priest got much better at stabilizing the early board.
Yeah,
with minions. So priest definitely got much better at fighting back. However, I don't know what to do against Dr. Boom on turn three.
Especially if you use the coin here and you never get to play Twilight Guardian on four. Oh, wow. Yeah, that's going to be a bit tricky for Kibler. He's going to have the eyes wide open, popped out.
He was like, beat this.
Yeah.
3-4 Dark Cultist.
Thais is like, yo, do you think I mind?
Now, Thais has a really hard turn.
Yeah.
Do I pass or play Dr. Boom?
Do I get Shadow Ward Deathed? And lose the game?
To be fair, Shadow Ward Death would be pretty disastrous.
Yeah, it would be like, you lose the game straight up, I think, most of the time.
I think the Dragon Priest commonly runs one. I think some of them run two.
Yeah, Light Bomb comes in much later, and that's the most likely way you're going to lose the boom.
So, I think Light Bomb's actually very rare in Dragon Priest these days.
Well, it's one or two copies pretty frequently.
Yeah.
Alright, Power Shield, does that do anything at all?
It draws you a card, but you can't play Shadow Ward Death.
It makes it so the Boombot doesn't kill your Dark Cultist, which is what was probably going to do.
Yeah. So I guess you could play a Shrinkmeister to try to hit Dr. Boom for three. Eventually wear him down.
You can also just hit a boom button now and heal whatever repercussions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, those both options.
They're both pretty fine. Yeah, they're both pretty like.
Both bad. Because the problem with losing Dark Cultist on board without minions is that you don't actually have any benefits for the buffs.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh. The Boombots showed mercy.
Yeah, that was a pretty good outcome. They might not. In the future, depending on what he does here. I mean, healing him and healing himself. Is he going to heal himself?
Yeah, I think there's no point in healing the Dark Cultist. It's going to die to the Dr. Boom.
Yeah, the question is, do you expect him to trade into it or just push phase? Like, 7 damage is a lot.
Well,
Wrath of Power works.
I think the Boombot just has value because you have the Savage Roar. So I kind of like the Dr. Boom hit, even though you lose 7 damage. I think if you just control the priest, like if the priest is just always losing, it's back to that problem. Like, if you just never stabilize, nothing's going to work. Especially in a minion based deck.
There's a chance he can cycle the Wrath here if he gets like a good boom bot.
As long as it hits
3 or
two.
Better. Is it 2?
Because he has hero power?
Yeah. He can hero power too if he wants.
Ooh.
Or he can get nothing and just have to wrath for three.
Yeah, no, he has to wrath. He's got the Azure Drake at least.
Yeah, Kibler can play the Twilight Guardian and sacrifice it. That's going to put Dr. Boom on full health. Which then Blackwing Corruptor doesn't even deal with it, unfortunately. That's a little awkward. Nope.
Yeah, Dragonkin Sorcerer does the same exact thing, except... Yeah,
you don't lose a good minion.
Well, you might even buff it with something else because of the effect of Dragon.
Wouldn't you want to save that for next turn? Because next turn you have Power Word Shield with it.
Wouldn't you want to not die, Corruptor,
but it doesn't deal with the board.
The thing is that Dr. Boom won't be the only thing on the board either, right?
Sure, but are you really killing a 5-drop with 3 damage?
Yeah, because they're playing Hemet.
Oh no.
The only thing you're gonna have maybe kill is the Shredder. No.
Oh god. The Unstable Portal Hemet Nightmare.
I mean, all the druids these days, of course you're playing Hemet.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Gotta kill off all those beast rogues.
Yeah.
They're pretty good, actually. Jungle Panther. Can like re-stealth through Master of Disguise.
Alright. Well, here we go. Azure Drake. We need some big stuff. That is pretty nice big stuff,
that's
by the way.
That's good for so much damage. You might not even necessarily need it, though. He could just attack next turn and Savage Roar and then win. Like, that's getting to that point where, like, Force of Nature just might be raw damage. Mm-hmm. And Killer might just be blown out.
Yeah, I mean, he's 3 off lethal, right? If he plays Savage Roar. I mean, he might as well Force of Nature now instead.
2, right?
Because it's going to deal...
Well, you lose the value of Savage Roar because it trades into Dr. Boom. I think you Savage Roar now, and then...
Play Shade.
You play Shade, and then you just try to Force of Nature kill the next
turn. Well, the thing is, there's nothing this Dragonkin Sorcerer can do really to bother you too much, but the thing is, can it deny lethal? Like, there's another taunt that comes down. I don't know.
Yeah, it would have to be the new... Wormrest Agent, I think it's called.
Yeah, the 2/4 for 2 mana.
Yeah, that would absorb two of the treants.
Yeah, even if he has Light Bomb, he doesn't survive. Because remember, he still has to deal with the board.
Yeah, even there's after. No way. There's no way. There's no way that he does. Yeah, I think he just Savage Roar face and play the Shade.
I mean, he's going to be dealing 18 damage if he recovers here instead of the Shade, which means Force of Nature, you only need to get through.
Traded, wow.
Yeah.
That's respect.
A lot of respect.
He's afraid of, like, Valen's Chosen, maybe?
But even then, he gets one kill. It would have to be, like, this would have been a problem with Valen's Chosen. Yeah, this would have been a really big issue with, like, a single trade on Dr. Boom. And then maybe lethal's out of reach.
I think you want to play at least one Twilight Whelp.
He's one off lethal, right?
Well, if you're going to pull it, yeah. Problem is you can't play a second one because it stops
you can.
The activation of...
You might be that
desperate.
That desperate, right.
To like hope you get lucky off of a dragon.
Oh, he's got lethal now, never mind.
Yeah, he has lethal.
The Living Ruts.
Well, it turns out double innervate Dr. Boom on turn 3 is pretty strong.
Yep. As it turns out, it can survive
it literally
the whole
never
game.
Died.
Yeah.
Like this would be the turn he plays Dr. Boom if he didn't have innervate.
Right. I mean, he might have had Shredders, right? So the game.
And now we've come full circle. That Dr. Boom came out on turn 3 and hit 4 times, right?
Yeah.
So that's 28 damage. Yeah. Actually, 30 because of the Savage Roar. So
I think I might hit 3 times. Might hit 3 times instead of 4 because 4 would probably be like way over lethal. But
Dr.
Yeah.
Boom took tiny little Tice, put him in his backpack, and carried him to a game 4 victory. So that's a
They really
Shaman
needed
that. And Mage.
Yeah, now they only need 2 more points.
And Tice is done for the day.
Tice is done. We're probably gonna see this Mage from Life Coach. I'm still up in the air about it.
Yeah, I mean, I want to see the Shaman, I want to see the Mage. I think those two decks are still a little bit up in the air as far as exactly what they are. Well, the Notebook, is that it again?
I mean, right now they're just thinking, like, what's the best possibility of the Shaman versus the Mage? And they're looking at their lineup.
Would Kibler go out again? Looks pretty okay.
Yeah, now that, like, you know, the Priest lost here... It almost doesn't really matter what they send out. They have equal amount of like good and bad matchups, I think.
Yeah, they could turn like throw up Priest. If Kibler gets benched, then they have all the other options still, so it doesn't matter. And I think he's got a pretty okay matchup there, and he denies the bench rule.
Yeah, I agree.
It kind of works.
Priest is just always fine from this point.
Yeah.
I can't do too much around it.
I think if you lose again with Priest, it kind of doesn't matter because you're at that stage of like, we have to win with every deck anyways.
Yeah.
So... You're not really afraid of the bench rule.
Mm-hmm.
Unless Kibler wants to protect his Master of Duels win record.
Does that still continue
right,
on?
Good,
no,
this...
it doesn't. But, you know, so, sometimes it's more than just the prize money.
It's the pride, the right?
Yeah,
the pride money.
The glory.
Pride.
Yeah.
Get that little bit of bonus.
Yeah.
All right. Those are the standings there. We are going to see something interesting coming from Nihilim here. Both Mage and Shaman have a lot of creative potential.
Yeah, what I want to see is like a really good tweak on Shaman. They've gotten a lot of new tools, but unfortunately, most people would agree that because Paladin is kind of a natural counter to it, it's a little difficult to make work with the whole mid-range approach. Maybe RD, you figured it out.
Yeah, I think you're right about the Ancestral Teachings card.
Knowledge,
excuse me. Yeah. Thank you for being able to coach me before Jeparino. The Ancestral Knowledge, being able to draw effectively into the burn.
Yeah.
That would probably be my guess. If not, then it might be the European Shaman that we've been seeing circulate a little bit. But that deck feels like very average. It's like the same as like mid-range Paladin. It's good but not great.
But it still kind of works.
Is it totem based?
It still kind of works.
Totem based one or another one completely with like Mukla's Champion?
Oh no, the mid range one has like one Thunder Bluff Valiant.
Yeah, in Asia there's like that crazy.
That sounds like an Asia thing. But like the regular mid range Shaman just has like normal stuff like an Alakir and then like Zombie Chow early on, but you have like some interesting cards like Thunder Bluff Valiant in the middle there.
Okay.
I just really like that card, by the way.
Yeah.
Thunder Bluff Valiant. Yeah, it's really cool.
You don't have to go full on gimmick to make it work. You can just like sprinkle it in, it'll work sometimes.
Yeah. And there's a couple of TGT cards, like, and then sometimes they like cut back one Feral Spirits because it just feels like ineffective against all the 3/4s nowadays.
Makes sense.
It just feels like mid-range Shaman, unfortunately, despite the best efforts for Totem mid-range Shaman to be a thing, I think people maybe went too all-in on it. And they realize that just like a couple of tools are still pretty good.
Yeah, it's kind of like going all in on Silverhand Recruits, right? Like it's gonna work.
Yeah, like no one puts Warhorse Trainer in their deck. Yeah, so like, I'm gonna do that plus Silverhand.
Like that card too.
It's pretty good.
It's kind of cool in certain formats, but yeah, currently constructed, I don't think it's that good.
All right, well, it is gonna be a Priest from Kibler. That does seem to be like a very nice choice, and Shaman from RDU.
Yeah, I can't even be mad about the loss, really.
Like, what could happen?
Yes,
is that they could play Keep Away with Shaman. And then squeeze in like another matchup that Shaman would be really good at, and the Mage would be worse at.
Okay. Like so they just end up isolating something else.
Right. So they can get away with it. Okay. Druid's unfortunately bad against both, so they're in a really awkward spot. Now, of course, Life Coach could be throwing us all in a whack. He could be playing like Neville's Giants Mage.
Really. Oh my god, I hope so. With a Frost Giant?
That would be really cool. That would be really nice. I haven't seen that one play out yet, but I've heard great things.
Heard of it. There was like this one game.
Against Raynad?
Yeah, Raynad played against Rage, and it was like so long. It was like a 45-minute game, but it was crazy. Fatigue versus fatigue, and like pinging their face and then realizing they don't ping each other's face type thing. And then the reason why he was pinging his face so aggressive because he had Frost Giants, and he Frost Giant Echo Medivh into more stuff, into duplicate that into more giants.
More stuff, yeah.
I want it.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's like one of the coolest decks to watch. Unfortunately, it's got like a weird win rate.
By weird, probably mean.
No, it's like it's 50-ish. Like it's 50-ish, but like it depends on who plays it. But even Neville's himself, who loves the deck and is probably obsessed with it, kind of agrees that the deck is not the best one.
All right, still a lot of excitement to see what Shaman it's going to be.
The Mech Shaman,
it's probably Mech Shaman, yeah.
Lava like Burst Reno. Yep, there it is.
Yep, looks like Mech. Typical.
Now, the flip side is he could have no new cards. It could just be all...
The old stuff. Cards. Oh, Kibler with the
crazy. Clockwork Knight is still just pretty good, though.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Like, it still just kind of works with the theme.
It's better than Fel Reaver if you want to go for a more safer approach.
Toskar Totemic.
Yeah, that was from TGT. He played he played that in the last week of ATLC as well.
So that's interesting.
Yeah, I think it might be the same deck.
This is like the nuts for the priest, though.
Yeah,
you're not breaking this.
Oh my goodness, that's insane.
He didn't have a dragon, and now he does. So that's really bad. Because now before he could have power maced that down. And this is where it goes downhill.
It's like with Shaman, it's bad if you can't get much of an aggressive start, but he literally got no aggressive start.
Yeah, like a Mech Warrior.
Like on aggression, it's at a zero.
He had a weapon. Like Power Mace is something that you don't mind starting off with.
I actually think you crackled a 2/4.
Yeah, he has a 75% chance to kill. That's pretty good odds.
I mean, yeah, you could also just... If you the problem with Power Mace is you give him a card draw, and then Velen's Chosen would just punish you for not killing it. But you could also get a crazy shred on the following turn by just I mean, a crazy Annoyatron if you do that.
So Saturn's game's already a 75%.
Yeah.
Oh, if this is 3,
25% chance to lose. Oh.
Oh, he gets it.
All right.
That was nuts. All right. Well,
still a crazy follow-up for Kibler.
It's okay, though, because now the Northshire Cleric won't, like, run away with the game because Priest...
Yeah, Power Mace takes care of it, and then he's got some mech action Warper right after that.
Looking
yeah.
very good, actually, for RDU if you can stabilize this.
Mech Warper becomes a Yeti.
Yeah, sounds a little difficult to remove.
Okay. Well, I think it's possible he'll just play the Piloted Treader. He gets the most value out of the Annoyatron, but...
Yeah, but
that's not going to work in this case.
Wow. Okay.
Second Dark Cult is the dream. So that way you can
doesn't matter force what they do
a buff to happen.
Okay.
Do you just play all the mechs? You just like Mech Warper, pop the Power Mace somewhere.
I think if you do that, you do Mech Warper, Whirling Zapmatic, then Attack Face, then play the Annoyatron. Because even if the Annoyatron gets buffed, it's not really going to do anything.
Yeah. Okay.
It does I thought protect you wanted to... your Zap-O-Matic, though.
No, it dies.
Like, it would die to pain in this case. Nova would also
assuming,
kill it.
Well, it protects it anyway, unless there's more damage.
Right.
Because it's two hits from two creatures.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. So if you play Annoyatron and then the buff goes on the Annoyatron, it at least defends it so that way it doesn't die to the Dark Cult.
Nova would kill it. Would kill like the Zap-O-Matic and the Annoyatron,
that's
so
true.
Maybe that's even scarier.
Mm-hmm. Shadow or Pain is the ultimate... killer though.
Yeah, of course.
So then, what's the actual best play?
I kind of like Powder Shredder, but it's kind of it feels weak just because it's so wonky. Maybe Mech Warper on its own, followed by the two other mechs, and you buff the Mech Warper to make it a 4/5. Maybe that's enough.
No, that's passive. Oh, he goes for the attack. I thought he skipped the attack.
Yeah, because it trades directly into the Dark Cultist, so you'd want to at least get the buff on there.
Yeah. Oh man, what if you don't? The thing is, you're always wary of the Earthshock, so you can't put all your eggs in one basket even against a Shaman. So if you play, say, Dragonkin Sorcerer and you hope to get a crazy buff on it, it might actually not do much.
I mean, you can still trade into this Pilot Shredder, and the second Dark Cultist will survive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you can heal
you
to
can
draw a card.
Probably Pain if you want to fully control
it. Yeah, you can draw a card in Pain. I think that might not be bad.
Yeah, I think it's probably the best.
I think Kibler might not be playing like the cards that Kalenta was with like Cabals and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, he was playing a Shrink, but maybe he just plays one Pain. Yeah.
It would be really weird if you played Shadowward Pain, Cabal, Shadowward Pain.
Oh,
Shrink,
that has to be Shadowward Pain.
Yeah.
There's no way Kibler ever lets that live. Or do you just like, can you please not kill this?
Yeah. It was like a potentially lucky moment.
But... Yeah, it could have been crazy. Uh-oh.
And a death.
That would have been last turn.
So, now it's again awkward because the Northshire Cleric presents like healing possibilities to draw cards.
Yeah, I mean, Lava Bursting, it doesn't sound like something you ever want to do.
It's almost unavoidable too because no matter what you put out, health-wise, the Northshire Cleric can get buffed from the Dark Cultist.
You just Tuskar Totemic and play nothing, and then you just ram the board with four mechs next turn.
You just play all the mechs next turn and hope he doesn't have like
try
a
to get
crazy
like a tempo
turn.
Push.
Yeah.
How much? So you can play it all for six mana.
Right? Yeah, you can play all of it for six mana, but not five right now.
That sounds like the better play. If you pick up a Mana Tide, it's also not too bad. Healing's terrible though.
No, it's definitely not the one he wanted.
Yeah, double healing is happening. Just look. Oh no.
You can't get a healing after it. You would have to Hero Power first,
then play the Duskar. Right. Oh, that's
okay. Rough. Well, RDU's future play just got countered by that draw.
Unless Kibler plays greedy and ends up using a Nova now, but I doubt it. Kibler is way too solid a player to have to go all in on this.
He doesn't need to play the Nova now. Not to mention it's off curve.
Yeah, Dragonkin is so much better.
I think he can evaluate if he wants to actually buff stuff or keep his Dark Cultist alive, and I think keeping the Cultist alive is better.
Yeah, you just want a creature quantity at all times against Shaman. Even if you have Holy Nova, Holy Nova might just not clear everything you want.
So you would heal first the Dark Cultist and then draw. Okay. Well,
unless he wants to trade it away. There's
it's the same
chance,
thing,
right?
I guess.
Oh my goodness, that punish next
turn.
So
he's greedy.
Yeah, going for the greedy clear, but it might actually work out depending on how the follow-ups.
Yeah, I guess his AoE and retaliation is his minions on board.
Yeah, exactly. You can use them as removal, which might work out. The Inora Shroud is going to be a bit pesky, but he's got the...
I think he also wants to play around Lightning Storm by doing this.
Yeah, it has been seen in some Mech Shaman lists.
It isn't. It's not entirely unreasonable, because some Mech Shamans have like had backup contingency plans.
Yeah.
Similar to how like Mech Mages play Flame Strike, and I'm like, why? And
yeah,
it's just because they realize they need that sometimes because the game's gotten too board centric.
Yeah, it's always whenever like you overextend because you think it makes sense, then you lose.
Well, he can kill everything besides the 3/4, and that's just probably gonna be way good enough.
Yeah.
I don't see how hard you can ever win this game.
Yeah, the nuts draw from Keebler. I mean, it kind of compensates for what Thais did to him last game. It's got to come back, right?
Yeah.
I think the problem is that RDU's, like, he just didn't do damage. Like, Priest had 29 health.
Yeah, well, the start from Killer was crazy.
Zero. Yeah. And he can afford to heal his minions. That's how embarrassingly one-sided it's been so far.
Yeah, absolutely. And there goes the Black and Corruptor with the value. I hope you don't have a lead to that, so... Yeah, hope you have a...
It was a good play. It turned out perfectly fine.
I think it was so far ahead, it didn't really matter.
Yeah.
Unless RDU picks up, like... Doomhammers? No, he needed like Doomhammer to be now and then drop.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah, right. Drop it.
He just doesn't have enough time.
I mean, what do you kill here? Like, you'd be able to. It doesn't really matter what you kill. You can't play the long game because you're losing that. Yeah. You can't go phase because you're losing that.
You have
that,
to get Doomhammer. You have to top deck like Crackle and get spell damage to him.
Yeah, and you need to not be dead by that time.
Yeah, I think he's just gonna concede. So that's gonna wrap up game 7.
Yeah, Kibler wins with the Priest, so Shaman will have to go up against one of the three decks left for Value Town. It's not really that problematic, I guess, but the Mech Shaman now has its hand face up. Everybody knows what it is. Mm-hmm. It's nothing unexpected.
Yeah, it's pretty typical stuff. It might have a little bit of flavor. I mean, I think the Tuskar Totemic is kind of a weird thing, and that might work out to really good stuff. So, maybe it'll work. Maybe it'll surprise a few with a few other tech cards we haven't seen yet.
Yeah.
But, still a lot of play left.
Yeah, I'm just curious to know, though, that for the Tempo Mage from Life Coach, you know, we've seen him play that. He loved the deck when GBG came out. He played a bit of Tempo Mage. Mm-hmm. And he kept playing, like, of Mech Mage, that is, and he switched to Tempo Mech, like, kind of a hybrid. I wonder if he updated it with anything from TGT, if anything was worth changing. Because the deck was pretty consistent during ATLC. Like, is there a...
It's true. It's just like so many variants of it. Like there's just like the spell tempo deck, but I actually really liked the double Fel Reaver.
Yeah.
Tempo Mech Mage.
Yeah.
Just kind of all in most times, but the all in just worked almost every single time.
Yeah, they've got burn actually. They can get you down. Whereas I like how it was initially like a Shaman innovation where they basically had no draw, so they were just like, okay, let's go all in and punch face and top deck and lava burst. And then Mage was like, yeah, I can do that too. It'll work.
Turns out
you
know? It does pretty well.
Yeah, 8 damage to face. I mean, that's pretty standard nowadays.
All right, well, RDU did lose that, so he's threatened to get benched with as inconsistent as the Shaman is.
Dog with a full lineup,
though. Why not? Why not just play the Mage, right?
Sure, why not?
Is Patron isolated there because of Mech Shaman and Tempo Mage?
Well, not necessarily. I think the Paladin is still okay, even good against both. I think Mech Shaman's still too board-dependent, and Paladin's too effective at taking apart.
Yeah,
it still has no answer to Muster for battle. And Mage needs a very specific set of cards in order to take it out. Like, I don't know if Light Coach is playing the Arcane Missiles list, for example.
Yeah, with like the full-on one damage pings.
I also think the Secret Paladin has a lot of consistency issues. Like, you can just draw all the dumb secrets at the start.
Yeah, that's true. That's a while.
So it's certainly... I don't think there are any more like very one-sided matches left.
I think Druid Shaman might be kind of a difficult one for the Druid if the Shaman kind of comes out well.
Yeah,
I don't know though. Like where the Shaman list, the problem was it was very refined with the mechs and the direct damage. So like Tuskar Totemic is in. So like is Fel Reaver out?
I think they play the Fireguard Destroyer now, from what I recall. I'm not sure what RDU's
but something aggressive has to go out for like some of these cards. So if it's not that aggressive, it gives the Druid like a very big swing in the matchup. It's still not favored, but I don't think it's as one-sided as it once was.
Okay, well, I like Paladin choice here, coming out from Valley Town. And this will be okay because they're going to try to shut down the Shaman and then make sure they can get away with Druid and Warrior. Druid definitely has a better chance
against. Oh my. Shield and Minibot, Muster, Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah, there was a
fire. And a smile for Trump. Holy cow.
Two smiles. That's value. Two smiles on one.
Well.
You can justify keeping Mysterious Challenger, but would you ever justify throwing it away because it's too slow? You want to have earlier game?
I've seen many people keep it.
I guess maybe because he has early game, so mm-hmm. you'd never want to throw away Mysterious Challenger because you already have the Minibot and the monster. What else are you looking for?
The only thing you'd look for is just a lot, like just super early game opener with Divine Favor, but Divine Favor is just not going to work against this.
Shield Minibot is so problematic. It just kills everything.
Yeah. I think now with the Juggler, you can even point out the Minibot just to be super annoying.
The only thing it doesn't kill is the
Mech Warper, yeah. That's a bit of a risk, sure.
Yeah, I think Juggler is better just because you can also pop the shield from the Noatron with the Shield Minibot Juggle, and maybe you can kill that as well if it ends up coming down.
Agreed. Fire Guard Destroyer.
Wow, what a clunky position for RDU. Like, he has to sacrifice the Zap-O-Matic.
It's so silly because it's like, Mech Shaman is so dependent on like, okay, please don't play a minion.
Right, play nothing,
and
turn
then
one
like,
into...
All right, I win! And it's like, oh, they played a minion.
Yeah. They put a Leprechaun rip, yeah. It's pretty sad.
And I think you just still play the Whirling Zap-O-Matic.
Could you just totem
and play
Power Mace?
You could just play a totem
Mace?
And hope, and hope the Paladin doesn't kill it.
That's true, you can do that. But I think the Knife Juggler represents too much of a threat, you have to kill it. Now, here's the funny thing, too. Because he did this, Shield and Minibot is gonna come out, and then the Power Mace is gonna actually kill it.
Yeah, but
so
you can always use the two charges on it and top like a Shredder and be pretty happy.
So you go face,
or do you?
With the Power Mace, right? Power face.
You have to win eventually. So.
Yeah, I guess so. You can start the race right now.
You have two Lava Bursts.
Yeah,
I mean he's already
got 10 damage.
Dead.
Yeah,
he's gotta find the other 15 damage.
All right. Well, Monster's coming down. Again, super annoying card.
So you're never going to get bored back again.
It's over, yeah.
You're going to hope Fire Guard Destroyer gets him some damage, and you just roll as high as possible. 7, baby. Here we go. 7. Not 4.
Not 5.
Not even 6. We're going for 7.
It's 4.
No, it's a 7.
It's 4.
7, baby!
Okay.
Oh, Frodo was right.
I'm excited. These are high production sound effects.
So the production crew was like, guys, please, whatever you do, do not, like, you know, rattle the...
Yeah,
the
do not drum roll.
Like, do not do it. We're like, all right, well, we're definitely going to try to sneak it in one or two times.
But that 7 damage does actually put RDU on the board a little bit.
Yeah. It forces Trump to respond with a trade.
I think he's just going to True Silver. I mean, he has to attack in anyway.
Right.
So the True Silver, he loses nothing on the board. He only takes 5.
Yeah, it sounds pretty good.
I think 5 damage is pretty relevant if RDU can just start racing.
Yeah.
But you cannot consecrate here. Like, not against this deck.
No. There's way too many flood opportunities with
right.
Mage.
It's just your only option.
How should, like, Mech Shaman even deal with Secret Valley, like, when they get the Mysterious Challenger out?
Oh, you just kill him before that.
Or, yeah.
Right.
It's like, they play Mysterious Challenger, and then you just kill him.
That sounds super reliable. All right.
Okay.
Might work out. Let's see if he picks up another mech.
Nice.
Wow, that's a great mech, actually.
Really
that's a crazy one.
That face. And then do 4 more damage to his opponent. And
heal face? No. You have to kill the 2-2. Yeah. Because you want your creature to be out of range.
Of the
board. Right, because there's 5 health on it only.
Yeah, you want 4 to True Silver to hit.
Oh, but I want to hit the face.
Yeah, maybe we'll play some games later on just to make sure you don't point anything at any creatures. Get that satisfied.
Yeah. Oh. Yes!
Okay.
Yes,
Frodo making the call. He's like 7-6.
Hit the face.
Go face. Yeah, that's right. Looks like the correct play.
I love it. Now it's
always the correct play.
Now he's so close. He has 2 lava bursts.
Yeah. And a lot of overload.
Well, he has no overload next turn.
Yeah, of course.
So, like, if a minion sticks onto the board, like a Gilbilin Stalker, then you just put the Flame Tongue Totem hit, and then it's like lethal the following turn.
There are no Gilbilin Stalkers since then.
Patient Assassin.
The Pilot Shredder.
Yeah, Patient Assassin.
The Piloted Shredder.
Calling
That's
it.
True.
Or even the Patient Assassin.
Doomsayer would be good.
Let's not get greedy.
Because you could get...
Greed.
What?
Greed boys.
Does he have lethal
knife? Also, Trump didn't put a shredder in the middle. Meanwhile, RDU did put a shredder in the middle. You tell me who's a better technical player.
Yeah, I think RDU has it by a long shot.
As what?
He's actually, he's too off lethal anyway. Trump is too off lethal. Is he trying to represent lethal so that RDU makes trades?
4-7.
No, he's like too
off. RDU can't afford a trade. His hand does not.
Yeah, there's
Trump,
no way.
Trump is too off lethal. You're right.
I don't know if he miscalculated or if he really wants to force RDU in a weird spot.
He's like basically like saying, I have
Trezor. I think the reasoning is next turn I get protected by Noble Sack.
Look at RDU. He's like, what? Why did you do that?
Do you have second True Silver?
And Trump is, wow, he doesn't even need Mysterious Challenger.
But here's the thing, I don't know if Trump's aware, but like this deck doesn't actually run two True Silvers very frequently.
No, I think he's got a Coghammer. I don't think he plays two. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. But maybe like the Coghammer would also give lethal. But like next turn, that's the problem. Like he's a little bit of mana off lethal.
I think if RDU is really like tuned into what people are playing in Secret Pally, he'll go face and be pretty happy about it.
RDU goes all in with Shaman pretty frequently. The mech Shaman.
I think you have to just Flame Tongue Totem and then Fire Tang.
And just push it.
Ooh, whoa!
Looking for that Stone Claw.
Oh, he gets the Stone Claw Totem. But then the Consecration is still alive.
Yeah, he just voids it.
Yeah. Trump's still without the lethal, but at least he's got this challenger, right? That's gonna work for him.
I don't know. I really like the Flame Tongue play.
The thing is, you have the Consec, right?
The thing is, like, you have two Lava Burst and Flame Tongue, and you can't play all of those next turn anyway. And this game is not going two more turns. Someone is winning in the next turn. Yeah.
Consecration, though, is like, because Trump is playing Consecration, he can't also let RDU attack. So he's going to have to make a lot of trades, which gives RDU a bit more time, right?
But he's got like a good board for trading.
Yeah. A lot of 1/1s to throw away, basically. Whoa.
Mysterious Challenger.
So he's just going to play with the Noble Sack in mind.
I think he will make it so that Noble Sacrifice will force.
Well, how do you do that? Wait, you have to
kill off a creature.
Yeah. You have to kill off the spider.
You can kill off every creature except the subscribe.
Yeah. All right. So.
And then you still have lethal next turn. Yeah. So RDU needs lightning. No,
he needs to kill off a shredder and get a doomsayer.
And then redemption hits.
No, doomsayer doesn't activate till his turn.
No, you.
Oh, kill his opponent's shredder. Stall. Kill your opponent's shredder. My bad. I thought you meant kill his own shredder.
A Trump's line of play worked out pretty well when you consider the fact that he was planning to do this. I mean, it gives him a lot of trading. The 2 extra damage from Flame Tongue, would it have mattered ever?
It would matter. Yes. It would matter if he drew Lightning Bolt.
If he drew Lightning Bolt, he would have won. You're right. Yeah.
He has Lightning Bolt. We saw it.
Yeah, we saw it earlier in his like opening hand. I think he just mulliganed it away. Mm-hmm. So there was a chance he top decked it.
But I just feel with this line of play, he had 0% chance to win this game.
Yeah.
Well, he still has like, can you do No, you can't. There's too many secrets on the field, so it's like everything.
You know it's everything.
I wonder if he can survive at all, and I don't think he can because it's like if you roll Spell Power Totem, and then Lava Bursts, there's still too much damage because of Redemption.
Trump is amused. All secrets triggering at the end of the turn.
Okay, Doomsayer.
I don't know.
It's like too slow to see.
I see nothing.
It looks like he's just gonna play just because of the lack of time. Because secrets take forever!
Yeah, Trump's going full metronome on us. Did you see that? Wow, what has gone on? What transpired in this game?
I mean, that was a good totem to roll.
Yeah, the best one, probably.
Nope.
Ship's cannon.
Repentance. Trump still has lethal, way over lethal.
Yeah, he's got first ship spirit, so.
Yep.
We know that's an effect.
He exhausted all 5 of his secrets, I think.
Yeah, and the mech Shaman from RDU not working out. That's 2 games of...
How crazy would it be if, like, secrets took so long, and if RDU had, like, animations, that it skipped Trump's turn?
That's pretty far off from happening.
Oh, man. One day, though. Like, you know, in...
I don't know.
Brentbro wants to release cards for hundreds of years, he said. Give it 100 years in this year's challenge with 20 secrets.
RDU, your spot is requested on the bench.
Amaz is being, pretty roleplayish, right?
You know, as a former rival of RDU back in the day, Amaz and RDU used to play each other all the time. So maybe it gives him great pleasure to bench RDU.
Oh, you think so?
Yeah, a little bit of a we'll just say that. We'll go with that narrative.
Okay, sure, that sounds good.
Well, the good news is now we will finally have to find out what is in Life Coach's Mage Deck.
That's right, and it's tied 4-4. So Valuetown, they were down pretty significantly, and they've climbed back very well. So it's down to Dog versus Life Coach.
Yeah, and my question again is the same. Is Temple Mage just hard countering the 2 decks from Dogs? Yes. From Dogs or not?
Well, I think it's just going to be Patron Warrior. So.
Well, you can't counter both decks. That's the thing. You still have to win with everything.
Yeah.
So even like, if it counters both decks, does can RDU so win with Shaman?
Against Patron, it might be possible.
Yeah, I think it's actually pretty close. Warrior, it's right? pretty close.
But now with the double shield block, it's making things a little bit more awkward where there's a lot of armor gain. But it's still
I don't think the shield block really matters much. I think it's all about like the fact there's 2 Fiery War Axes in the deck these days, and that makes it so you just stop the damage before it happens.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you shield block, it's like, okay, so I'll shield block and then take 18. Yeah, it's okay, okay.
No, is the shield slam that adds actually like a little bit of a
yeah, removal? Understandably, yeah, understandably. It might help a little bit more with the shield slam. All right, well, we'll have to see. We'll have to get there first.
Yeah, that's right. The winner of this, because I know some people are tuning in, they're not really sure of the format. The winner of this goes to tomorrow with a 1-0 score, and they play in the winner's match for spot directly into the grand finals. And
then, against Cloud9.
Yeah, if they lose, then they have to try one more time to get a spot in the semifinal, guaranteed. Otherwise, they lose twice from that point on. Well, you know, it kind of sucks. They have to play a third and fourth place match.
Yeah.
Then again, we kind of figured out that the first and last spots were kind of the best ones to operate from, I guess.
First is probably a little better.
Yeah, first, obviously. Yeah.
First is a lot better by at least $20,000 per player.
Yeah. Well, that's in terms of the seeding, like fourth place, you only have to win 3 total. First place, you only have to win 3 total.
3 total, yeah. And
but if you're 0-2, I don't know.
I don't know if you're winning 3 in a row. After that. But that's quite a story.
Yeah, that would be.
If quite you get it done.
Story indeed. Life Coach versus Dog. It's Mage versus Druid. I think Dog's already accepted his fate. He has to play the Druid versus that Tempo Mage.
Now, here's the funny thing. If that's actually Freeze Mage,
then our minds are blown. If that's
Life Coach is probably not winning because both Patron Warrior and Druid do quite well against it.
Malygos makes things a little more bearable sometimes, but against Patron, you're usually just blown out.
It has a pretty decent chance against Patron. Patron doesn't have as much life gain.
They do now, though.
Because of shield blocks?
Yeah.
True.
Yeah, Zalay played the a No Armor Smith version, I think, for a little bit, with like Cruel Taskmasters, like double Cruel Task.
But it's not 0%.
No, not at all. Yeah, far
there's
from
like
it,
no
actually.
Matchup that are 0%.
Freeze Mage versus Control Warrior is like
it's
2%.
It's better
because has it changed? Okay, Emperor changed it.
Maybe like 5% now. 5 to 10%.
Yeah, you play like an Archmage, and then the warrior somehow doesn't have removal.
Yeah, ever.
And then you create a lot of fireballs, then play Thorsen later.
And then you get them all for 3 mana each.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sounds super consistent, but I mean, it's the only way to win, so you take it when you see it.
All right, well, that does look like a Mech Mage variety, but there is like this new Mech Mage that's like very... It's just basically Tempo Mage with mechs.
Right, the whole same array of spells, Flamewaker play.
Right, so it could be that the Annoyatron I think is one of those somewhat optional mechs, so it does lead me to believe it is just the traditional Mech Mage. But the traditional Mech Mage these days, they have like the Fel Reavers and stuff, which really does destroy Druid pretty well.
Yeah, Dog's got a pretty sweet hand though. The Wild Growth, the Rat, the Swipe. He needed removal to handle the early Mech onslaught, and he's gonna be able to cure with a Shredder pretty nicely.
Hmm.
Yeah,
I'm gonna think that Snowcharger is gonna be a really valuable MVP for the rest of the series if Life Coach, assuming he doesn't win here, because he can keep that Patron frozen for a while, and you know the Mech Mage still does have a lot of benefit of early game tempo because of stuff like that.
Yeah.
So the argument for not coin Wild Growth thing here is I assume I won't need my Wrath on turn 2, but you don't expect Life Coach to play Freeze, so you probably will need your Wrath on turn 2. So I think playing Wild Growth first is. The only way you're not going to waste it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's Antonitis. I actually think the Tempo Mech Mage does drop Antonitis.
Really, with spare parts and all? I mean, they run them for a family.
Yeah, so I think Antonitis actually tells us it is just Mech Mage. I don't think we can expect to see too many surprises anymore.
Yeah, the Tempo Mech Mage has like weird stuff like Effigy sometimes, too. It's like... It's very peculiar with how it actually functions. And there's so many weird individual tech cards that you can't ever account for.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so this will provoke the Wrath.
Of Dog. That was pretty close.
Dog. Yep. All right, Life Coach hasn't really managed to get much on the board, but that's generally the case when you don't have a Mech Warper.
Yep. Splitter Tank, pretty straightforward here.
Yeah, Blast Mage could be very important. Like, if it hits...
Ooh, Innervate.
With 3 hits of the Shredder, that could just decide the game right then and there. Assuming Life Coach goes for it, I mean, I don't see. Would you play Snow Chugger instead? Ever? I don't think so.
Yeah, this is a very risky Blast Mage.
You can always trade away the Spider Tank if things go wrong, right? It's a little bad value.
Yeah.
What's your play? Is Snow Chugger ping and go face and let him trade?
I think you just have to curve out. So I think next turn you still need a 5. You're not going to play the Blast Mage too much. So
yeah.
I think Blast Mage kind of sucks here, but it's kind of made up by the fact that next turn you'll have a better play with Snow Chugger Spider Tank.
You could probably Fireball as well. I mean, it's a lot of overkill, and Joan of the Claw would be even harder to handle, but you could at least kill what's inside the Shredder most of the time, and then maybe get a 5 with Spider Tank, Snow Chugger. Oh my god!
And it's bad.
Wow.
Swipe does not clear. It needed 3 attack for a swipe clear.
Yikes.
Well, that's pretty much what we were talking about. Keeper of the Grove can salvage the Spider Tank, right? He can always finish it off.
Luger's thinking of going face right now, by the way.
Yeah, because he's thinking, well, I don't have to worry about swipe. Do I have the opportunity to go face here and be aggressive?
Would Savage War be an issue again? That's another question. Well,
how about Drake into second innervate?
Innervate
twice.
That would be swipe.
That would be game ending.
That'd be really cool.
Yeah. I'd like that.
I think just the Drake by itself is really bad, though, so I don't
it
like
is.
That.
It is. It's high risk.
If anything, I like the
I think you could
pilot
just,
a Shredder.
Yeah, I probably like the thing is with a Shredder, you might be contesting that Blast Mage with whatever comes out of it. Like, if it's a 3 attack minion, it might ping it, and then you can finish it off with Swipe later. But there's that.
I guess so. I don't really like Keeper of the Grove at all, either, because it's just so weak against the Blast Mage, and then your opponent decisively controls the board. But Shredder always adds this weird layer of, man, it's so laborious to try to remove.
Yeah, what if you just swipe the Blast Mage? Is that just fine?
I guess. You can just innervate and kill the 3-2 then.
Yeah, and then you can always curve out with a Shredder on 6, or Keeper of the Grove with a Heal Power if you go 2-3.
You're always going to be playing from behind from the stage, unless you get like a really big card like the Ancient of War or Doctor Wu or something.
Yeah,
that's the big problem is that he loses initiative on the board. I think he's like okay with it because he still has minions to play.
Oh my god, that's a free 2-3.
Wow, very sick. And now Druid can't deal with this.
Play a Shredder and hope.
I mean, Ancient of War has to be the one that kills his board.
Ah, another minion gets picked up, so that's something else. Yeah. I mean, it might actually work well with the Keeper of the Grove to finish off something. Or another swipe as well. There's always that. Wow.
Shredder doesn't really matter too much. It gets reduced by 1.
Yeah, but the cost reduction doesn't matter, but the body itself, I think, is...
Yeah, you could make an argument that you care more about the board. Since, you know, even next turn, Antoninus just dropped on the board is still very devastating. So I think just playing Pilot Shredder and securing the board is, like, one of the most important things.
I think you leave the Druid's Pilot Shredder up, though. It's just too much of a pain to kill it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Freeze the face.
You invest so much just to get rid of it.
I think you want to play around Swipe a little bit better, so you just use the 3-4 to kill the 2-3.
Is there, like, an aid drop you care about from the Aspirant? I can't think of one. A combination of 8 mana that would actually wreck this would be Keeper of the Grove.
You actually
swipe.
Consider just going full out face. I just think another swipe might punish you a bit here.
Yeah,
if you don't make
that's
trade.
What he's thinking about.
Mind Control Tech could be something disastrous as well.
Right, that could be like that's actually very legitimate in Druid as well.
Life Coach not putting a Shredder in the middle. Dog puts a Shredder in the middle.
It's been a running trend for players without any cards to play the Shredder.
Yeah, oh, when they have no minions on board,
right?
They know
right
to play
middle.
It. Right.
Yeah,
in
yeah.
The middle.
It's a good play. The game even helps, right? It's kind of like that track.
I was like, why did I put this card in here?
Yeah. For the inevitable Dr. Boom, because this deck probably has Dr. Boom.
It probably does have it. Yeah.
Good old Mech Mage. Have you seen any TGT cards out of this?
Nope.
Would any TGT cards help?
Maybe out of the Shredder.
There are no TGT cards in the Patron Warrior list.
Clockwork Knight, I think, is a good fit.
Knight. Yeah.
Yeah, I think Asia's got something like that again. But Asia has everything, so I guess.
They also make everything.
Yeah.
Wow.
I want my hero power, damn it. Oh.
Not bad.
Not bad at all.
It helps stabilize. It's just like mech boards, basically mechs hitting other mechs. Mech druid, as far as I'm concerned.
Is the druid drake better than keeper? Because keeper, like, obviously.
Keeper, no, I think you need limit damage like, right now.
BGH. I also be tempted to play BGH.
Yeah.
Even though you know next turn is the Dr. Boom turn.
Yeah, but you're so far behind, you have to take that kind of risk.
Right. I agree.
Alright, that's mostly irrelevant. Do you play the Archmage? I mean, you can kill
two minions with
the Archmage. I mean, you might lose it, but you're still far ahead.
Play into Swipe, and that could be one thing that's disastrous.
No, it doesn't have to. You can suicide your Shredder. Oh, no, you wouldn't even suicide your Shredder. You can suicide your Mech
Warper. Your Mech Warper, if you'd like. Yeah, okay, sure, I see what you mean. You're still vulnerable to Swipe, but you
Shredder
still
Shredder into 2-2, Mech Warper into 4-2, play Archmage, and Dog... Like, you know he doesn't have Swipe. So he basically needs Druid of the Claw and Suicide in charge mode.
Yep.
And then he has no board, no turn, and takes 5 damage. Like, are you sad about that?
No. Yeah, no, I guess not.
No.
I mean, you're more likely to find... Then again, you played a lot of a lot of minions at this point, so maybe you won't find exactly what you need. But you've got, like, Tinkertowns left, probably. Another Blast Mage to work with a Mech Warper.
I really like
Antonitis. Arcane, yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah, I'd be surprised otherwise. If you're not gonna play into Swipe, might as well just go for it then. Antonitis here is just a game-winning move for Life Coach, and Dog needs to have the exact answer. That's not it.
That is pretty much everything.
Drake has to get
everything but it.
Andrew can't do stop it.
Is that Roar? Would that work? Oh my god! Hail Mary!
Doomsayer! Doomsayer!
Yeah, let's do this.
Wait for it.
Let's doom this.
Oh, Life Coach is like praying, like, please, Doomsayer.
Please not.
But please not, Doomsayer. You're
right. Yeah, I don't think Life Coach wants Doomsayer.
He's just.
Alright, that's a lot of damage.
Do you go for the damage? Because you could die to combo.
Yeah, well, could you, actually?
Yes. There has to be something, right?
Well, no, you can't.
Oh, that's right.
You can't die to combo. So you just push until you have no more legs behind your fireballs.
It's okay.
Fireball toy.
Yeah, you're right.
Haha. Now that's 3 HP. Dog can't even Wild Growth for an extra card.
He could Innervate first. I think he can then Wild Growth.
Nope, I've made that mistake many times.
It doesn't work.
Harrison Jones. Oh, jeez.
The Aspirant works, that's right. The Aspirant works because it's actually a temp, like a
complete. Right, right. You gain an attack.
That's right, never mind.
Yes, I've been in that boat, obviously.
So I've done it so many times.
It does not work.
I've done double Wild Growth with Aspirant on the board a lot.
Dog has been extremely unlucky in this tournament. So
it's
far.
With his Druid.
Yeah.
His Druid seems to be running bad.
Really bad.
It does have a lot of tech choices, too.
There's BGH and Harrison, that's right.
Wants to be, BGH's not even really a tech choice. It's like mandatory.
Yeah. No, nowadays I think it is. Because like there's so many more aggressive decks.
But the Mysterious Challenger, that's like the way you win back.
Yeah.
It.
It's better than Keeper.
You hero power shot, something down, and then you BGH the Mysterious Challenger.
After Revenge.
Yep.
Yeah. It's the way to win against Secret Valley. I mean, Keeper of the Grove doesn't do anything to a 6-6, really, so...
Well, one more game is all Nilum needs.
Next Shaman, RDU, everything's on you.
In the winner's finals.
Yeah, and that Mech Shaman, that's just pretty inconsistent stuff. But, I mean, if you're talking about inconsistency, Dog's there to high-five him with his Druid deck.
Yeah, I guess so.
What is less consistent?
Druid or Patron?
No, Druid or
Mech Shaman.
Or Shaman. Like, yes, Dog's less than
well, Shaman
both,
head-to-head
right?
Against the Druid is pretty good.
Yeah.
Just because it punishes slow starts. However, Druids have recently bolstered their early starts with Living Roots.
You can zoo them down.
Have we seen Darnassus?
We have. Well, remember he had the...
I don't think we've seen Living Roots for him, though.
No. And
we've seen from the other druids.
Right. From Thais, I think, yeah.
From Shrivko also had that with Nimsh's druid that likes to play.
So that might cost him a little bit. I mean, that one mana spell sometimes kills a card that hit you for 10.
Yeah, and you can always, like, against certain matchups, you can also just drop the 1-1s and it'll do a little bit of work. Against Shaman, I don't know if that's ever worth it because of Zap-O-Matic, but...
Yeah.
And I don't know if the changes to Shaman benefit too much against Druid, but I have to imagine Tuskar Totemic is very annoying to deal with if
yeah,
they get the...
Definitely.
The Stoneclaw Totem, or they get the Manantide Totems, like, all these different things.
RDU has been debenched.
Unbenched.
Debenched.
Debenched?
Debenched.
De-unbenched. And then he's rebenched. Is that what that means?
I don't even know what's going on.
Right. It means RDU can play the next game.
Okay. Yeah, that's what we're trying to say here.
Yes. Now, Dog probably will just queue up the Patron Warrior.
Why? He's got one of both.
Yeah, I guess he hasn't revealed Warrior.
Yeah, so he might just keep it hidden.
In his best interest to keep Warrior hidden.
Right. Definitely play Druid then.
Because I'm sure
I forgot about that, but that's absolutely correct.
Yep. And then, this is not actually going to be relevant at all, but if Dog loses with your Druid, and then he loses with Warrior, he gets benched twice in the same series.
You can't. There's only one win left from the other team.
Yeah, exactly. It's not relevant because the series is over, but he ends the series how he began it, which is benched.
That's pretty sad.
Mm.
That's all right.
Could be a highlight for tomorrow. Could we patch up video together if that happens?
Oh, well, it's just, you know, because Dog's like a nice guy, so it's just you feel bad for him. If like, Ecop got benched, I think no one would care.
Yeah, no one would care, I think, yeah.
Maybe Ecop's makes mom, sense. But that's about it.
Just Ecop.
Ecop would even make a clown, you know, be very clowny about it. It's fine.
Maybe.
Just make you big eyes on the bench.
Yeah, sounds about right.
That is pretty interesting, though, that Warrior's the left. It's still such a dominant class in the tournament scene.
Has he played it?
Not yet.
I think so.
Every game he's lost has been with Druid. And he just hasn't played Warrior.
Not yet, no. Maybe there's something weird about it. I don't know.
It might be, like, control.
Yeah. Could be definitely control Warrior.
It could be control and... But the problem... Okay, so when did Tice win with Druid?
Very early. I think it was the second game. Yeah.
Okay. And then they didn't bring out the Warrior then, so it probably is Patron.
I know Dog's been practicing a lot of Patron to improve.
Well, it's Nylan versus Valley Town.
Wow.
That's news to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Versus.
Oh, that's sad. I just realized that there's a dollar sign on top of that thing.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what they're here to do, to win the monies.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, we don't have any true inference of what kind of Warrior this is.
Not yet. Every Warrior has those three cards in
Garrosh it. Garrosh is Patron. Magnai is Control. I thought it was pretty obvious at this point that the only players who play Control Warrior...
No, I think Hyped
playing... Mike had Magni.
Yeah.
Who did?
Hyped.
He was playing Patron?
Yes.
Yeah, that's why he lost.
Because he went against the rules of the universe.
Yeah, I mean, Magni is like, you have to pay for it. It's Wallet Warrior Incarnate. You can't go against that. It's an established rule.
All right, well, I don't know if... Oh, yeah, he didn't hit the button yet. Good, good. He still had another chance to drop those lava bursts. Now, the Fireguard Destroyer, if it doesn't get executed, it's going to do probably a lot of work against this Warrior deck, because most of the minions early on are very scrawny, and even if you have a weapon to clear it, you're hitting it twice.
Honestly, RDU's hand for Mech Shaman is probably one of the better ones against Warrior. You have, like, two sticky mechs, an Inoitron that's almost...
three sticky mechs.
Yeah, three sticky mechs if you count the Inoitron, basically. So, yeah, this is looking very dangerous for Dog.
I don't know if I like playing Inoitron so early. It feels like it's so good against the early game weapons.
It's true. It's true. But you want to coin a 4-drop. You want to coin a Shredder, not a 4-drop. You want to coin a Shredder, and then you want to play the Fireguard Destroyer, and then you want to play the other Shredder.
That's true.
That's the 3-4-5 you manipulate with Overload.
That is a very good line. But then, what do you gain versus playing this Inoitron now compared to later? I guess it's...
You could just Power Mace here, I suppose.
Yeah, maybe it's just
a liability.
Actually, I like Power Mace more.
Whoa, double Doomhammer. If he doesn't kill it with the first one, second one's definitely going to do it. But it's a bit... It's going to clog his hand, though. I think the game might not go long enough.
I like it. It's very reminiscent of the Korean... I think this is like how Koreans really like to play the Shaman. And I think it was introduced in a North American scene by Harasol. So it's a very powerful bursty Shaman. The only thing is that you usually don't use all the resources. Like, there's too much overload, there's too many Doomhammer hits.
Yeah.
And also you might get awkward draws. But in this case, the draw is okay, and the Warrior's taking its time.
Alright, Death Spike comes down. I think that means Fireguard Destroyer is better play than Shredder.
Yeah, because you're forcing the Execute after, or Slime at least. Or Whirlwind, you know, there's like 1,000 plays you're forcing.
Yeah, I don't like the Shredder.
I mean, the Shredder does have something to stick onto the body.
Yeah. It feels like the Fireguard Destroyer requires removal, and the Shredder just dies to the weapon.
But don't you want to make... Okay, yeah. Shredder does deal 6 at least, and possibly more.
What is the implications of playing Fireguard Destroyer? That means he only has 5 mana total next turn.
Yeah, the overload, could be...
Yeah, it seems to be fine.
Because
you also save the weapon. Like, if you play the Shredder... Yeah. Actually, no, you can just Shredder, not attack.
Well,
like
one thing you have to consider is that you have two Doomhammers, and you might want to start getting them out soon.
Yeah. That's kind of what I was thinking.
Every turn
about.
You miss is 4 damage.
Mm-hmm. Even still, I think that the size of the creature is really important. I think you don't attack. Yep. I think that's it.
So you could always... above the second one and 4... Oh, wow. Another Death Spite for Dog. The thing is, he's not armoring up while he's doing all this. And that kind of plays into RDU's goal, which is just deal damage once and get out of there. If I top deck Lava Burst, then that's fine too.
Yeah, but this also makes Battle Rage live for Dog, and he's not dipping to critical health. So I think he's...
Just yet, yeah.
Still think he's okay. Gonna clear.
Let's see if this works. Oh, no, he's not gonna clear.
Man of Rage.
Wow!
That's great.
That's a bit of an annoying...
For Dog.
Yeah,
it's okay for RDU, though.
Yeah, I mean, he can't play some of his swing cards, maybe, if he wants them.
Oh, no.
Now the Shredder's good.
No,
really
now
good.
The Shredder's really good.
Yeah.
The
Shredder's really scary.
Well, I mean, it would have been better if he had the opportunity to play the Shredder and then play, like, Zap-Matic and try to buff it or something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, it's going to be difficult to try and stabilize. If he uses his executes this early on, he can't actually
double mana wraith the dream.
Two mana wraith? That's the way to balance.
Yeah, nature. Let's do this.
Seven mana.
Oh no.
Ooh, an Undercity Valiant. That card is...
I think he has to play the Frothing.
Cool. It's not good.
It's cool.
It's cool.
Yeah.
The art's cool. Wow.
He's gonna try to stall more. I kind of thought he'd have to play the Frothing to actually contest the board at some stage in this game.
Oh, that's a pretty decent pick.
I think if there's a sign that he should start whacking away. But
do you...
The mana race is annoying, man.
Yeah.
You can coin a totem, and that would actually be hilarious, because the mana race wouldn't die if it's a taunt.
You're right. It could be the... Yeah, the mana race is actually making it problematic for your opponent, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not the only one. You. Yeah, he can't go for like a crazy. He needs like two Emperor Ticks instead of one if he wants to go that way.
And unstable goal and everything is just way too expensive. Three mana.
Yeah, he's playing
he's
minions.
Gonna coin out the Zap-O-Matic.
Yeah, four is like you force him to spread the damage and have the Whirlwind or an Execute, which means you're taking away combo pieces, right?
He's second Whirlwind.
Yeah.
Which he has. And Dog instantly plays Patron with second Whirlwind.
Yeah, he's gonna end with four here.
Yikes, and that's going to make RDU race with the Doomhammers.
Yeah, it's a pretty okay race, though. I think you're happy to take this one, because you might be able to win it if you find, like, Lava Burst.
It's going to be close. It's going to be very close. If he picks up Crackle or whatever next couple turns.
Another Fire Guard Destroyer.
Those are staying in hand for the rest of the game. Do you just stow them instead of Rockbiter here, or are you afraid of the Ghoul and you want to punch the damage in right now?
You need to stall for time.
You need to win the game.
Ooh, that's a good totem.
I don't know about stalling for time.
Yeah.
Well, this stalls for a little bit with the totem.
Alright, so Rockbiter deals 10 next turn. Assuming Dog armors up, that's 5. No
Battle
shield
Rage.
Launch.
Lava Burst does it. Rockbiter does it.
Oh,
Crackle can do it.
The ghouls are there. Those are crazy draws.
The ghouls are pretty valuable.
That's true.
Yeah. That's a lot of ghouls. And a lot of patrons. One ghoul, one frothing.
Hmm. Do you really want to be that greedy, though?
Yeah, maybe not. There's like three cards he's been holding on to for a while now. I don't think you can. You're right.
I think you can still just set up a way to kill him in three turns.
Yeah.
And still guarantee yourself to be safe.
It's kind of awkward for RDU. He has to weigh so much. Like, he has to weigh like 10 damage on these ghouls. And he's just giving his opponent more damage output?
No.
The first time that card is drawn ever.
He needed that
deck.
To be burned.
Turn 8.
That was like burn or bust. Oh, man.
But he's going to burn. It's not in a comfortable way.
Can you just play Fireguard Destroyers?
You might consider it. Do you really force trades, though? Because I think that at this point,
it helps you get past the second unstable goal, because you need to use Rock by your next turn.
Do you assume you're dead, though?
I mean, I think you have to be optimistic. If he has Warsong Commander, you almost certainly lose. But it's like, it's at that stage where it's gotten very grim.
Well.
What do you do here with the dudes?
I mean, there's almost, like, you could double attack into the ghoul, but then you're almost dead. Yeah. Like, you have to Rockbiter this and waste 4 damage and feed your opponent more patrons. That's how bad this is. That's how bad this is. I don't even know.
I wasn't expecting this, but I guess he's just going to try to wipe out patrons this way, but it doesn't actually wipe patrons.
It does. In fact,
he actually just kills himself.
It wipes the shaman pretty well.
Oh, yeah.
No, he's dead.
He literally killed himself. But to be fair, it was very bleak to begin with. It just seemed unlikely.
All right, well, we are at the final point here.
No matter who wins, that's it.
We need to do that before, like, something crazy happens, like a stable portal.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Dog wins the game. Not with Druid, though.
Dog is down in the dumpster, right?
Well, no, he's actually high in the skies. He was benched just an hour and a half ago.
Oh, yeah. It must feel a lot better now.
Now he's no longer the underdog.
He has a really kind of weird slow druid deck.
Yeah.
And he's got to win twice, right? Against the next shaman.
And his druid deck has had some of the most unbelievably atrocious starts we've seen this entire tournament.
But isn't that mean he's due for the god druid start? Because it's like, druid's known to be consistent across the board, and you lose the games, you don't draw wild growth, but that's like the 35-40% of the time.
I think there are druid players and non-druid players, and the druid players just start the game with wild growth.
That's right.
And he might just not be a druid player.
It's actually a $10 purchase inside the store.
Yeah.
You go to the shop option.
Oh!
He bought it.
Druid player.
Yeah.
Wow.
Maybe he got, like, he first, you know, he did forsake druid for so long. No.
It's part of it.
That's actually really good.
But it's not available right now. It was only a limited time buy, so people looking for it right now.
Was it in beta?
But for the next hero skin that's in druid, I'm sure they'll put it back on sale.
Double wild growth, though.
That's not bad, considering he actually has an ability to utilize it. A lot of times, a second wild growth is not useful because you don't actually have time to play compared to a minion.
Yeah, I can't wait for the Harrison on Doomhammer.
That's going to be pretty big, but I think that might not even be the story of the
game. Ooh, Wrath. That's pretty good, too.
Yeah, it sucks a bit because you have to delay your 5-drop, but at the same time, it's still the best play you'll ever have, and you deny the Shredder on the following turn, right?
Yes.
Yeah, if you get Shredder, you might just take too much damage this game. I think he's thinking about it. There's definitely something to think about, but I think he's eventually going to decide to Wrath the Mech Warper.
Oh man, Dog is going for the ballsy plays.
And he's not terribly punished for it.
Not yet, yeah.
In fact, it ends up somewhat being
that way.
It would have been played
by one.
Dog is happy.
Yep, so he realizes, okay, no Shredder, no way to really take advantage of the curve. Azure Drake's going to really pull him back in it, and he's going to force a situation where his opponent has to trade into it or remove it.
Yeah, and the Force of Nature is also a pretty good way to clear the board in a desperate moment.
Are we going to crackle this Drake?
Yeah.
No, I don't think we are. I think we're playing Flame Tongue and Spider Tank and suiciding the
Mech Warper.
Temporarily buffed Mech Warper.
Okay.
Yeah, that sounds good. I mean, the 4 health minions are pretty tough to handle.
I feel like the payoff from the crackle is very high, though, because then you can leverage a very healthy board with 2/3/4s and a 2/3, and you still have Flame Tongue to him the following turn.
I just think you get more value out of the Flame Tongue if you play it.
That's like true. Now. On turn 6, what does your opponent do?
Well, Dog will just wipe everything off with the 2 Spider Tanks drop. He'll swipe and Wrath the 2 Spider Tanks, and then the Flame Tongue will be left with 2 health alone.
It is a pretty safe option. I like it.
Yeah.
Crackle is also good finishing damage, so you don't have to necessarily use it as removal pieces here.
There's a chance that even without a board, he still makes it through.
Ooh.
Wow, RDU.
He says there's no good swipe option.
Okay.
Wow.
And this is how a game is ended.
Yeah.
This looks pretty bleak for RDU going forward.
I think that was that them shouting at the play that which was made.
Yeah,
because he's about to. I mean,
he's just about to wipe the board. Just
yeah, super. Like he doesn't think there's a good swipe, but
I think the 4/4 has to kill the 3/4 first.
Why?
So it stays alive, right?
I mean, you hit everything for 2 with the Druid Drake, right? With the swipe.
Yeah.
So you can also, kill the can kill the Flame Tongue. You can let the Mech Warper on one health.
Oh, you want to leave the Mech Warper?
On one health? I think I'm comfortable with it, yeah.
Okay. Oh, man. But, okay, he still has some burn damage.
I think he's counting on weapons to carry him forward, because he knows he's going to have, like, an extra 10 damage here, so he needs to...
Oh, man, that's a big draw.
Crazy draw here for 6 damage.
Oh, he's got some spell power coming up.
Yeah.
He can actually kill the Drake with Earthshock. He's probably not going to.
Okay, so he's got 5, 8, 11 guaranteed next turn. Possible lethal. If, if the spell power totem survives.
Oh man, what a way to go.
Which most likely will happen. Oh no, because of Harrison Jones.
Harrison Jones, big. That's a bit of an issue. That's the thing. Like Harrison Jones, the problem is it takes 5 of your mana as Dog to actually play.
And also Dog has this Force of Nature and Savage Roar. So this means if he can survive 2 more turns and have a reasonable
One turn, Darnassus.
Yeah, Darnassus Fire and
Right, the Darnassus Aspirin. Dude, he's turning this around, so RDU needs to draw some way to end it.
RDU can actually...
Plus 6.
Another
that's lethal. That's 31.
That's 31.
Yeah.
Annoyatron
stops it.
Stops 6 damage.
Mm-hmm.
So you kill the Drake with the Earthshock just to negate the...
Okay. How much... He hypothetically could kill him? No, he only has 13 damage max because of 6 plus 7 on Crackle.
Right.
Yeah.
So he needs to kill the Drake, right? He's going to Crackle...
Lava Burst, Earth Shock. He could still win. Like, the stuff
that
Kuto could
That was
sword.
A 4 roll. The lowest. Oh, no.
But he can still win.
Yeah. Gosh.
Yeah, okay. it'll take another Lava Burst or a Doomhammer.
No, because the Dirtle Hero Power, it'll take another Crackle.
Another Crackle, right.
So he has to Earth Shock the Drake now, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
And then play a Annoyatron.
I'm just surprised, like, why did he crackle there? Because he has a spell damage, he wants the extra,
Yeah, and I think he isn't sure if he has the mana to do it next turn.
Mm-hmm.
You probably would be able to, the thing is...
Wow! Such an aggressive move, he's gonna put Dog down to 4.
Just in case he gets the, other...
Yeah?
Other Lava Burst.
And at game 11, RDU's putting all his trust onto the last Lava Burst, or another Crackle.
It's doable, it's fully doable, but... Better top deck, RDU.
Alright, well, the damage isn't quite there. Dog is 25 right
now.
Yeah,
he's a little shy. He's gonna have to trade into his
It's basically whatever he feels like is the best.
Emperor might be
Yeah, just Emperor here.
Yeah, Emperor armor up. Make sure you don't die to like a spell damage bolt. Or a Doomhammer, even.
I mean, Pilot Shredder... I mean, it actually doesn't really matter because Pilot Shredder is more sticky.
Yeah.
So he feels like that could be his best chance.
As long as you like throw stuff on the board. If you have... Just 2 minions next turn you win off combo.
In fact, it might be slightly better because of it, because now there's more minions on the board to get through. Annoyatron.
He's gonna get a Rockbiter and he's gonna go for a Doomsayer. Just watch.
Rockbiter into Doomsayer. I mean, he just needs something. Rockbiter!
Oh,
and
God.
He has to go into the Doomsayer. Everyone's going nuts downstairs.
Yeah, it's crazy.
They are going
this
crazy.
This is his only option to win the game. He has to go for a Doomsayer. He has to go for a Doomsayer and then get like something ridiculous, like a Lava Burst with Spell Damage Totem or a Crackle.
That Crackle earlier
yeah.
Not doing, just doing the minimum amount of damage.
Just 2 more damage would
just
have done
more
it.
2 damage
yeah.
would have been it.
Yeah. The upper 50 percentile would have actually won
so
the game straight
So he's
up.
Wondering, can he get away with holding Rockbiter?
And waiting for
Doomsayer. And waiting because can his opponent kill him?
Yeah, I think you assume you're dead, right?
Okay, so if his opponent has a Savage Roar... Just one Savage Roar, how much damage does he take?
It's plus 10.
11, 15,
yeah, he's
plus
way dead.
20.
He's dead, just a Savage Roar.
Yeah.
One Roar is enough to kill you. You might just try the Rockbiter
okay.
all in. This
or,
has to
or
be
is
it,
he,
right?
Where's he going with his Rockbiter?
Oh.
No, he goes face! And that's it! Dog survives with 2 HP, and the Druid, even though it lost 3 games through terrible, terrible misfortune, Dog has... Been able to win where it counted the most. RDU is devastated.
Yep, the Shaman deck does not end up pulling it through. Oh, Dog was down to 1 for funsies.
Yeah, just attacking
that
into
was
the Annoyatron.
So dramatic.
Wow, the craziest finish to this series I
Trump
could imagine.
Trump is yelling as loud as he can.
Was that Trump?
Yeah, and
yeah,
that's, oh my God. That's going to be in the next Trump Reacts to Things video.
I
suppose
so.
Trump hugs Dog.
All right, well, Valley Town does take it. Well deserved. I mean, they really did get really screwed on the luck early on. And at the end, it was just good enough. I'm not going to say good RNG. It was just good enough.
There were definitely some good moments and bad moments. As it looks like, as you saw, they're getting ready for an interview. What's happening, Amos? Okay.
The funny thing is, like, if that crackle just rolled a little higher.
Yeah, well, two more damage, basically.
Two more damage would have been it.
I mean, a lot of really small things. We could pick at crackle, but there's a lot of other consequences.
But I think that the all-in play almost panned out for him. Mm-hmm. Like, the all-in play almost panned out.
Yeah, he didn't trade into the Drake and lost his board. And that was another thing, too.
Yeah.
All right, let's get him in.
Okay. Cool stuff.
Are we all coming in?
Yeah. All right. Yeah. So we don't actually have enough chairs for everybody.
We can just stand.
So you guys, you just put the crown around.
You deserve a seat for that.
No, we'll just stand. All right.
There's a seat. Someone can sit in it.
Sure, go ahead. Okay. I'm just a dog. I don't deserve a seat.
Yeah. So how does it feel? Let's talk to you, dog. You had some pretty bad beats with Druid, and it looked really stressful at times. Being down 5-4, what's going through your mind at that time?
I don't know, just Druid's hard because if you don't draw well, you can't do anything, right? Like sometimes you just like wanna perform well, but there's really not anything you can do. Being behind is, for me, doesn't really mean anything because you play the best you can either way, so like how is being down any different?
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of the nature of card games, right? Sometimes things can go your way, sometimes they can't. How did you guys feel going into the match against Nilum Trump? Like, did you guys feel very good about your chances? Did you expect it to be that close on game 11?
Well, we actually had a lot of strategizing, and in this format, Cloud9 got to pick their opponent, and we actually made the assumption that they were going to pick Tempo Storm. So we actually kind of prepared against Neon, just a little bit. Mm-hmm. The decks we brought were actually really good. Kibler made a really good call choosing to bring Priest. Priest was really good against their lineup. We actually weren't entirely expecting that. But, man, good stuff.
What's with the notebook? It seems to be that point of conversation because you're always writing in it very meticulously. Is that the secret to all the strats there? You don't tell me what's in it, but is that the key?
Is that
your tome of knowledge?
I'd like to think that I'm one of the people in Hearthstone who actually does a lot of research and does a lot of preparation. I've seen just about every single game that Nilum has played in the Archon League. And got to study up on your opponents to get that small edge. Yeah. When it's a best of 11, any small edge like stockpiles a lot because there are so many games.
I think that the sort of research and you know the meticulousness that Trump approached the regular season with actually had a lot to do with our success. I think that we put ourselves in a lot of positions that we were able to, you know, bring an excellent lineup against our opponents to outpick them at various stages of the actual match, and it went a long way toward, you know, us being here.
Do you have any comments about the lack of Hunter from Nilum at all? I wanted to ask them about it, but I'll ask you guys first.
Mistake.
I was surprised. I was like, why not? Know? Do you have any opinion on
that? That was a little strange. Hunter's just so good right now. It's one of the top
and instead products. Bringing Shaman.
Yeah, you know they tried to make Shaman go face, but it didn't quite work out. In fact, in that game, even though Twitch would have gone face, they would actually be wrong. Face was not the place. The Azure Drake getting left up in the last game.
And then you guys were screaming, yes!
We literally were. Yeah. Trump and I were watching downstairs on the couch, and as soon as he attacked the face, we were just like, oh my god, yes, he won this face! Game!
That's good. Well, I mean, that wrapped up the first day. You guys go on to Cloud9. Do you guys feel like is this the hardest hurdle that you have to overcome, getting that first win? Maybe not necessarily against your opponent, but just, you know, for your guys itself, because you guys are the unestablished team compared to some other people.
What are you talking about? We got the Master of Duels on our team. And once again, Kibler has a good record. We're going to continue to do just fine.
You might as well just give that sign to me, Amaz, instead of holding it 15 feet away in the dark. So tomorrow, 10 a.m. Pacific Daylight Savings Time, Cloud9 versus Valuetown, followed by Tempo Storm versus Nilum. Caster Jeparino is next, and I guess that's how we end this interview. Thank you very much, guys. Congratulations, and good luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
All right, so we're going to take a quick break. I guess we'll take a look at the bracket as well before we finish up this little segment here. And just a recap, we had the first match of the day. Temple Storm did take on Cloud9, and it was pretty one-sided for Cloud9's favor. A lot of, you can argue mistakes, but ultimately Cloud9 played very solid. That was the story of that series. And then in match number two, Nilum versus Valuetown was very close. It was a lot of swings back and forth. Came down to the last game in 2 hit points. Highly recommend you guys go watch it if you're just tuning in. And don't worry, even though we're done for the matches today, we have, again, that caster, Jeparino, where you get to watch Noxus and Crypt battle for $5,000. I'm sure he's gonna make a fool of himself, so that's going to be fun. I'm used to it. We're going to have a good time. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.